Good morning. I'm Sal Pizzurro. I'd like to thank all of you for coming. Before I get started, I'd like to discuss a couple of housekeeping issues. First of all, over the last 7 weeks, the agenda has changed many times, but there's an addendum, a one-page addendum at the registration desk. Some of you may have it with the revised agenda for the day. We're sorry that Kelly Ruba cannot be here, but a representative from the New Jersey Office of Emergency Management will take your place. Once again, I'm Sal Pizzurro. Welcome to our Summit on New Jersey Disability Issues. I'd like to go through quickly why we're here. And this actually started only 7 weeks ago. 7 weeks ago, Dr. Michael Rickards, who I will introduce in a moment, and I were having a telephone conversation, and it dawned on us that state disability policy is changing in a direction that we're not necessarily happy with, recognizing that we have a governor with his hands full in terms of trying to provide services for people with less dollars than we've had in the past. And we thought it would be a good idea to have a summit to bring together people who might have an opportunity or be in a position to affect positive change. And the issues regarding people with disabilities are multifaceted, I like to say. They deal with certainly residential care that's been in the newspapers and on the websites for the last year, community care. And what we see are disappearing services. In some cases, we've seen our governor, who was invited here, by the way, we've seen him take a step in terms of trying to provide services that he was not sure about maybe 6 months ago. But it has not come as far as we would like. And the challenges, and those challenges are one, dealing with employment. People with disabilities in New Jersey and nationally have three times the unemployment rate of their non-disabled peers. They also have a great difficulty getting affordable housing and accessible housing. An interesting issue, and one of the things that got me interested in the housing issue, having been in the field of disability policy for many decades, I first became concerned about housing, thinking that I knew everything about disability issues that there were. I realized that I still need to be educated. About 8 months ago, when I was hospitalized and my roommate, who's from Bergen County, was a double amputee with no legs and in a wheelchair, and he told me that he lived in an apartment in Bergen County that was not handicapped accessible, and he could not get his wheelchair into the bathroom, and he could not get the wheelchair into or out of his apartment because there were stairs. So I thought, well, that's a public policy issue. And I immediately called people that I knew in government in New Jersey, both in the county and in the state, and colleagues that I knew in Washington. And they all told me the same thing. There will be a tremendous backlog that you will face in trying to get accessible housing for this individual. So when I finally got to the person in New Jersey who was, I guess, the last stop, they told me this individual would have to wait a minimum of 7 years for an accessible apartment. I said, this guy can't even get into his apartment. What do we do? He's 73 years old. We don't even know if he'll be alive 7 years from now. So I realize I still need to be educated, along with the public at large. Transportation is a major issue. We are lucky we have Ed Hoff from New Jersey Transit here to talk about accessible transportation issues. And of course, community acquiescence, which I define as the ability to have everyone on your side. Healthcare. We know from studies that people with disabilities do not get access to appropriate healthcare unless they are lucky enough to have a very dedicated family member who's with them to make sure they have proper health insurance, get them to the doctor, get them to all the places they need to be. Having said that very quickly, the briefest overview of this conference that I can think of, I'd like to begin by introducing the executive director of the Hall Institute of Public Policy, Dr. Michael Rickards.
Thank you very much, Sal. He's right. I had a conversation with him, it's only 2 months ago, and I suggested the idea of a conference dealing with the problems of the disabled. The next time I talked to him, he had set up already a restaurant, a date, and a program. I said, oh my gosh. So I'm delighted to be here and to welcome all of you on behalf of the whole Institute, and I'm especially honored today to have a person who's been a great philanthropist, not just to the whole Institute, but also to the problems of the disabled and medical research in so many ways. Our founder, George Hall.
Thank you, Michael. Michael does all the work, and I just get to show up and say a few words. So it's a great honor for me. Without a lot of effort, frankly, Michael does all the work. And he's done so much good work in so many different areas. Just Friday, he did a summit on the pension fund. And before that, we did some work on issues as horse racing. And we've done a lot on healthcare over the years. So Michael's done a great job. I generally don't get to come to these, but this was a particularly important one for me to try to get to. I may not stay long. We're having another lovely day on Wall Street today, so I may have to get back to New York and deal with the problems of the day. But I'll give you a couple of quick anecdotes. I've never really had anybody in my family with any disability, but I almost came close, so I do have a mild appreciation for it. When I was a freshman in college, I actually developed an acoustic neuroma and had to have that removed. And at 17 years old, kind of in the prime of my life, I lost a hearing in one side of my head, lost facial nerves, so I actually looked kind of strange. Lost my balance, and I could barely walk. And so I spent 8 weeks at NYU Medical Center, actually had surgery, and it was somewhat miraculous that the hearing recovered and that I got it back. But I did have some taste for what it's like to not have all of not have everything working properly and having to deal with challenges in society where everything is kind of built towards people that have both of their ears and working properly and all their hearing and all their other sensory perception. So this became important to me, and over time as I moved on, I became a big supporter at NYU in the Department of Otolaryngology. We've done a lot of work. We've done a lot of work for cochlear implants. And the head of the department, Dr. Luwani, actually did a television show on the website that you could see and had tremendous response. So Michael and the whole Institute have been doing a lot of work in these types of areas. Another one, there was an interview that he did with a good friend of mine, Michelle Smigel, and many of you may know Robert and Michelle Smigel. They're very, very much activists in the autism community. They have two children with autism. So autism is something that has really just taken a tremendous toll emotionally and financially on families. And I actually have met, I have a lot of friends, unfortunately, friends that have children and nieces and nephews with autism. And it's really become almost, maybe not technical, but technically an epidemic, but it seems to me to be an epidemic. And I'm also involved with the Child Study Center in NYU and the Child Mind Institute of New York. And we've done a lot of work with Autism Speaks and so forth. And so many of these issues are so complicated, and that's why it's important to continue to discuss them and study them and learn what everybody else has to say about it. At the time, early on in autism, I remember there were a lot of people that were convinced that it was the vaccinations that children were getting that was causing autism. So I spent a fair amount of time with scientists, and they said there's absolutely no proof, there's no evidence. As a matter of fact, there's no evidence to even think that's realistic, and I think now that theory has been disproven. And what was interesting to me that they were most concerned about the fact that if enough people stop getting vaccinations, then we'll have the risk of an epidemic, the 19th century type of epidemic. So these issues are complicated, they're important to study. I appreciate the legislators, and government policy officials that have come. I'd like to congratulate Sal for your work and advocacy. I was disappointed to hear, we've always tried to be bipartisan, the Hall Institute and Michael try to be bipartisan. And I can see where this somewhat comes down to a little bit of a divide between Republicans and and Democrats. But I was disappointed to hear that a number of the Republicans weren't decided not to come, viewing this group as this advocacy group as more of a Democratic advocacy group, which is unfortunate. It's important to advocate for people that need help in society. By the same token, it's important that we figure out, particularly in a tough economy, how do we pay for the kind of things that you're advocating for. So I hope everybody keeps that in mind. I'll give you one last anecdote, and then I'll sit down. 20 years ago, when I started the company that I continue to manage, having been through some illness in my life and feeling fortunate to be able to start this company, I decided that I was going to try to create a program and hire people that had various disabilities so I could try to give back a little bit to people that were less fortunate than I was. And there were two law firms in particular that I spoke to, and they both advised me not to do it. And the reason they said was because of the statutes and the ADA and the for a young company, it's impossible to really service someone, you know, particular types of people with certain disabilities, and that we would put in the company in jeopardy for financial liability and so forth if it didn't work out. Now, that sounds awful and it sounds harsh, but I think it's important to realize that we need to have an economy that works, an economy that can deal with all the problems in our society, and that if we advocate too much or if we're too harsh in our appreciation for economics, then it really doesn't help anybody. It doesn't help get what we really think we need to achieve. So I hope everybody enjoys the day. I'd like to stay longer. I may have to leave early. But again, let me thank the state legislators for coming. And rather than forget one name, I won't mention anybody. But you know who you are, and thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. At this time, I'd like to introduce the senator who represents us in the 36th Legislative District, Senator Paul Sarlo.
Thank you, Sal, and good morning, everybody. Welcome to District 36, the heart of the Meadowlands here in South Bergen, and I'm glad at the opportunity stop in and say hello to everybody. Dr. Bizzurro, if you live in South Bergen, you live in this region, you know Sal Bizzurro. He is an advocate for those who are some of our most vulnerable citizens. And whether you pass him on the street, you see him at a function, he will always remind you that government needs to do more to help those who are in need. So, Dr. Sal, thank you for all the work that you do on behalf of our most vulnerable citizens. I have the opportunity to just give some brief remarks, and I unfortunately have to leave as well. It's a busy day today, but you're going to hear some very talented legislators today who are some of the greatest advocates we have in government on behalf of those who are most vulnerable, those with disabilities, children who are suffering from autism, those who have dedicated a career in the legislature fighting for these causes, and they're going to be able to share some of their thoughts, the policies that they've implemented, sponsored, that will go a long way in continuing to protect our most vulnerable citizens. Just before I mention a few of them, I just want to reach out to George Hall. I had the opportunity to meet George, I guess it's almost about 8 years ago when I first went into the legislature. And George is a very, very successful businessman. But back then, George was looking at different ways of how he could give back. Not just giving back from a charitable sense, but how he could create debate and discussion and bring some very talented people together. And George created the Hall Institute. And George, every time a paper is published, I always go out of my way to make sure I read it. They open up the thought process. They really make you think about issues that are so important to us, not only here in New Jersey, but across the country. So George, thank you for lending your talents to a whole different field and bringing people together, whether it's talking about investments, whether it's talking about education, whether it's talking about children with autism. You enlighten us and bring some of the smartest people around to the table and publish some really, really important articles. So thank you, George, for the work that you do here in New Jersey. As the chairman of the Senate Budget and Appropriations Committee, of course, issues that are important in dealing with those who have disabilities, those who are vulnerable, children with autism, come across our desk all the time. We have with us our Majority Leader, Senator Barbara Buono, and Senator Cunningham from Sandra Cunningham from Jersey City, two very, very important advocates on that committee for all the causes that you represent. Our budget committee, we spend a lot of time looking at these issues, and I don't want to get partisan at all here, but it's been very frustrating for us the last 2 years because we've put forward, this past year especially, we put forward Senate Budget Bill 4000, which went a long way in correcting some of the massive cuts that were put forth by the governor's first year of office to make sure funding was in place. Government was doing its job as a safety net for those who need government the most. And unfortunately, the governor, through his pen, took a lot of it out of this budget. And we're seeing now there is dollars available. There is dollars available to protect those with disabilities. The discussion whether they should be left in places like Vineland or moved to community group homes, these are all important decisions and deliberations that we need to have. But unfortunately, we have a very difficult road ahead of us with this governor. I don't think he's on the same side as Sandra and Barbara as I are in fighting for the needs and the causes that you all represent. Do not give up the fight. We have a very important mission here, and that mission is to be a safety net, government to be a safety net for those who are in most in need, those who are most vulnerable. It's important that we continue to work together. And I pledge to you as the chairman of the Senate Budget and Appropriations Committee, every day that I'm down in Trenton, I will continue to fight for the needs of our most vulnerable. So thank you. This is a great showing. Have a great day. And we look forward to, George, more papers, more thoughts about how we can continue to improve this state of New Jersey. Thank you. God bless.
At this time, I'd like to introduce the state senator from the 31st Legislative District, Senator Sandra Cunningham.
Good morning. You know, it is a pleasure to be in a room where there are so many advocates for people with disabilities. I was telling a group of people at the table earlier when I came in, I grew up with an older cousin who was blind, and I learned early on the differences and the problems, issues that face people who have disabilities. My cousin's name was Iona, and she grew up in Patterson, and up until the age of 10 years old, she had her vision, so she was what we perceived as normal. At age 10, through whatever biological problem, she just went blind. And at that point, I saw what little we have available for people that are blind. 40 years ago, when we were still dealing with the same issues, transportation, lack of employment, affordable housing not being available, and just health issues. I can remember Ionia at one point was getting services from the Commission of the Blind. The Commission of the Blind was in Newark. Ionia lived in Patterson. And even though the Commission of the Blind was helpful in giving her a cane if she needed a cane or helping her with Braille, there was this problem of how she was going to get back and forth. The transportation issue was never really solved. It became an issue of who in the family could take time off from work to take her to the commission to get her Braille lessons or to take her to the doctor for health issues. When it was time for her or she wanted to experience living on her own and making some of her own choices and her own decisions, it became, how are you going to live? Where was the affordable housing? Where could you get a house or an apartment? Even though she was trained in Braille, there wasn't any help for finding employment. So she was therefore dependent upon family members to take care of her basic needs. And it's interesting because I saw that even though she was a few years older than me, I was able to make my own choices and decisions. And the simple things she could not make for herself. And it took away her self-confidence. When I talk to groups that talk about disabilities, I try to remind them that there is that lack of confidence that comes when you feel totally dependent upon other people. And even if there is legislation or rights that they have, sometimes there's difficulty in reaching out and getting those things that you deserve because you don't have the confidence to do it. It's interesting also that there's 15 to 20% of the world's population that is living with some sort of disability. However, even with that, people who are disabled are still looked upon as a burden to society. So I'm really hoping that even though I can't stay for this whole conference, that today, perhaps with all of you working together, there'll be some policy that will manifest out of today that will help people who are disabled be able to pursue an enviable life, that they'll be able to pursue a life of independence, and it will help them to have a better quality of life. So I thank you for inviting me, Dr. Pissarro, for being here. And I've been thinking about Ionia I often think about her. But because I knew I was coming to this conference, all as I was driving along, I was trying to think, what would Ionia say if she was here today? And I know one of the things that she would say, I hope that whatever you as advocates do will help to make other people feel a little bit better about their lives than perhaps she did. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Cunningham. Now it gives me great pleasure to introduce the Senator from the 18th Legislative District, Senator Barbara Bono.
Thank you, and good morning. I'm going to welcome you and say a few words and then wrap it up so you can get on with the good work that you came here for. I wanted to also recognize George Hall for his vision and his leadership. I certainly have used the Hall Institute reports as a resource for my work in the legislature, whether it was as the former chair of the Senate Budget and Appropriations Committee and now as Majority Leader. And I'd also like to thank Dr. Ricards and Dr. Pissarro for putting this very important event together today. You are without a doubt, as I look out at the sea of faces here, you are without a doubt some of the most passionate and dedicated group of advocates that I have had the good fortune to work alongside. As a member of the Senate Budget and Appropriations Committee and also as a member of the Budget and Appropriations Committee in the Assembly, I have had ample opportunity to witness your advocacy before the committee, some as parents, some as just advocates working for this organization, and I have never seen advocates with such fire in their eyes and love in their hearts, and we're very fortunate to have you there working on behalf of the disabled population in the state of New Jersey. Now, it just seems to me that you are willing for whatever it takes to do what it takes to enhance the quality of life of those who happen to be born in this world or become disabled. And few people are as dedicated to this cause as Dr. Pizzurro. I have to make note of him because I know his work. He has dedicated himself, he has harnessed his knowledge and his expertise to have a lifetime, to have a career dedicated to advocating for the rights of those with disabilities. Many of the major advancements we've seen over the last decades have his imprint on it. Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, IDEA, and throughout his entire career, Dr. Pizzurro has been relentless in his quest to ensure that opportunities are not denied to individuals simply because of the hand they were dealt. I identify with his passion. I identify with his pursuit of social justice for all. You know, we're very blessed to live in a democracy where the people are the sovereign, in a democracy where all voices should be heard. In fact, I think of my job, I mean, the reason I got involved in politics was to be that voice for those who had none, to be that voice for those who couldn't be heard because they were either marginalized or overlooked or ignored. And at every turn, I've been proud to support policies and services that help improve the quality of life of those with disabilities to help ensure that they can reach their full potential. But we need to look ahead, don't we? And I know that some of the speakers, Dr. Pizzurro, talked about what you are going to be discussing today, looking ahead in New Jersey. And we need to continue to provide and expand care options for individuals so that their families are empowered to choose the best possible option for them. We also need to improve access to those options so that no one languishes on these waiting lists that never really seem to get any shorter, do they? So I think that it's important to have conferences such as this because in determining and trying to figure out what the best use of our limited state resources are, we need everyone's help. We need your help. We need people to come to the table. We do not need people to finger point, to scapegoat, to name call. We need people, real leadership, real vision is holding conferences like this to bring people to the table to have a thoughtful discussion in resolving all of the very important issues that we are faced with today. I know we're all familiar with a very famous quote of Hubert Humphrey, but it's one of my favorites, and so I think it merits repeating. And he has said that the moral test of a government is how government treats those who are in the dawn of life, its children, in the twilight of life, its elderly, and in the shadows of life, the sick, the needy, the handicapped. And you know, I think an entire generation can be judged by this test. How we respond to this challenge, whether it's in flush times or in strained fiscal times, I believe is a test of our moral fabric as a free and just society. The fact that all of you are here today is not just encouraging, it is inspiring. And we need to come together to, we all know someone in our life. I have people in my families, we have friends, we have neighbors who live with disabilities, and each one of them deserves to live their life to the absolute fullest with dignity and respect. And it is our job, as I see it, to come together and to deliver on that promise. And my promise to you is that I will always be here to listen with an open ear and to respond with an eager heart. Best wishes to all of you for a wonderful and productive conference, and I look forward to working with you in the upcoming legislative session. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Bono. At this time, I'd like to introduce Assemblywoman Gary Scheer. I first met Assemblywoman Scheer in, I guess it was 2005 when he first ran for the Assembly, and I've gotten to know him since and members of his staff. And I will just tell you that he and collectively with a recently retired member of the Assembly, of Assemblyman Fred Scalera, have probably introduced more legislation dealing with people with disabilities than anyone I can think of in the history of the state legislature. So I'm very proud of what Assemblywoman Scheer has done and what Assemblyman Scalera had done as well. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Assemblyman Gary Scheer.
Good morning. Sorry, but when one has the opportunity to kiss the majority leader of the Senate hello, one usually wants to afford oneself of that opportunity. It is a great pleasure to be here this morning to join with you at this important conference and to acknowledge, as Senator Cunningham, Senator Buono, Senator Sarlo have said, and I'm sure you'll hear later in the day from other legislators as well, the incredible work that Sal Pizzurro has done, the single-mindedness that he has approached the subject of disabilities, certainly in terms of autism first and foremost. I was looking at all of the legislators who are going to appear today, and I thought to myself, thank God we're not all here together, or else we'd have a quorum call right here in East Rutherford. There are a lot of them. And they reflect not only their concern, but most importantly, their recognition of the tremendous importance of this issue, as well as of all of you sitting in this room. Your advocacy is important. Your advocacy is vital. I would be telling you something that was not true so early in the morning by suggesting that it was not. We also owe a debt of gratitude, as we know, to Michael Rickards and to George Hall for the work historically that they've done in so many issues, certainly autism first and foremost as well. One last person I'd like to mention who is not here and I don't believe who is due to be here is someone who served as my mentor for the first 4 years that I served in the Assembly. I'm now completing my sixth. And that gentleman's name is Joe Roberts. It might be a name that rings a bell with you. Joe Roberts served for over 22 years as a member of the General Assembly, representing the Camden District. He also served for 4 years as Speaker of the New Jersey State Assembly. And I will admit to you that he single-handedly, as a result of the advice and guidance that he received from Sal and George and Michael and so many others, that he single-handedly marshaled through the Assembly and with the good help of Senator Cunningham and so many others on the Senate side, was able to pass more legislation in a 2-year period than any other state in the Union. And to him, we all owe such a significant debt of gratitude, as we know. When Sal was gracious enough to call me and ask if I would do the keynote this morning, one thing immediately occurred to me, and that is, number one, how does one say no to Sal Pizzurro? And number two, why precisely am I being asked to speak? It seems to me at the conferences like this, one generally looks to a scholar, to an academic, to even a practitioner, to share insights which can only be given by those who are in the thick of it. But somehow it dawned upon me that as a result of the studies that we have accomplished already, as a result of the scholarship which has already been done and continues to be done, because more scholarship, more research is fundamental and vital, that nonetheless, this conference, this gathering, represents as well a time not only for scholarship, but a time of recommitment and commitment to action as well. As such, certainly, your recognition that the legislature and the executive, the governor's office, are vital to getting this agenda passed is one which is well-founded. I'm a poor representative of the legislature, but nonetheless, if you'll allow me. Let me first share with you figures which all of you know well and live and breathe each day. Between 1 in 94 or 1 in 96, depending on who you'd like to believe, children in the state of New Jersey have autism. 80% are under age 21, 25,000 in New Jersey. In the United States, according to the CDC, one in 166 children has autism. There has been no answer, only supposition, in terms of why the New Jersey figure is almost double the national figure. 2,355 students in 1999 were formally recorded as having autism. In 2005, that figure increased to 6,665, and that figure is in 2005. It tripled in just those 6 years. One's expectation is obviously that the number is even higher today. Another set of numbers, perhaps more frightening. In October 2009, the waiting list for housing services from the state of New Jersey was 8,000. Since that time, between 50 to 150 disabled adults have been provided with housing. It will take the state of New Jersey 53 years to provide the vital housing that is required for its disabled citizens. And that is assuming that no one is added to the list. The news gets only more disconcerting. In a survey of children with autism, 34% of respondents had no or little confidence in the success of transition planning when they would opt out of services provided by the state. 30% had no transition plan at all, a recognized and fundamental document for their success. Only 26% were fairly confident or confident when reaching the opt-out period. And despite legislative initiatives in Trenton, and there have been many, and many were signed by the governor, although there are others to do and to accomplish. Nonetheless, these figures fly in the face of the fact that New Jersey is one of the most advanced states in its recognition of autism and how best to deal with it. Someone said to me the other day, if these numbers suggest a state which is at the forefront, my gosh, can we only imagine where state number 49 and 50 is ranked and why? We are woefully overwhelmed by the issue's complexity and by its treatment, and exacerbated by a failing economy and impact on state resources. Bills that would allow numerous vital components of solving the issues confronting men and women and children with autism have yet to be accomplished. And yet, despite this cloud, if you will, at the same time, we're greeted with news that Representative Chris Smith and Senator Menendez, a Republican and a Democrat, what a novel idea in Washington, and perhaps after hearing about the lack of attendance of my Republican colleagues this morning at this important conference, what a novel idea in Trenton as well, that a Republican and Democrat would come together to ensure the reauthorization bill, which provides $693 million in so many vital areas of autism, $22 million for surveillance and research, $48 million for autism education, early detection and intervention, $161 million for research grants. Perhaps there is hope after all. Clearly, efforts to create a holistic and encompassing program must be continued. And first and foremost, I would argue amongst those, must be the role of our schools in not only identifying autism, but also providing solutions while a child is in school, and vitally, importantly, ensuring that when a child, well before the 21 opt-out period, but at age 17, or perhaps even younger, a meaningful, realistic transition plan is drafted and agreed upon. We need to ensure that trained and qualified staff are available. We need to ensure that communities colleges and senior colleges are offering courses, and students are encouraged to take those courses, which will not only provide them understanding of autism, but more importantly, actively work with the autistic community. And we must recognize as well the individual needs, the specific individual need of each child through the IEP. Mainstream where possible, utilize services of the community. At the same time, we greet with concern the cuts that were recently made by Governor Christie to the budget, which take away funds for a fundamental area, and that is in terms of adult medical daycare, which has unfortunately been severely cut as well. And those services, of course, benefit and are vital to the autistic community. But we know these figures, we know this information already. Despite reservations in a number of areas, one overriding concern, I would argue, again, confronts us, and that is aging out, the lack of transition when one hits that magic age of 21. The February 07 issue of the Journal of Intellectual Disability Research, in a study of 44 adults with autism, reported, unsurprisingly, that those who were supported in their employment status showed higher scores for executive functions. Not only did they have increased chances at employment, but their cognitive performance increased. The current statistics are dismal. Only 3% of adults with autism are full-time employees. Only 6% have paid full-time jobs. 49% live with family members, and 32% in residential care facilities. But in examining the cost of intervention, and costs are something which is on everyone's mind, and I must tell you that I stand before you as a relatively conservative member of the Democratic Party who believes that jobs must be created in this state and in all states to bring the economy where it needs to be. But nonetheless, one needs to look at the other side of the cost factor, and that is parents, guardians, brothers and sisters who must leave positions that they've had in order to take care of siblings or children who suffer with autism. It is estimated that the cost to society of those people needing to take off to care for and treat their siblings or children is more than equal to the cost of the treatment of the siblings alone, had it been provided by qualified care professionals in certain circumstances. Certainly, research demonstrates time and time again that preparation, education, and the greater awareness of all concerned when children with autism are in schools is critical to their future success. The Autism Task Force of October 09, in one of its numerous recommendations, states that school districts should be required to advise parents and guardians of all ASD students regarding the student's legal right with graduation, transitional, and post-school services within 30 days of their 17th birthday. I don't know if conferences like this or any conference will ultimately discover the causes for autism, the reason why New Jersey's numbers are twice those of the nation. But I do believe that it's within our grasp to ensure that the most critical problem, what do we do when children become adults? What do we do when children who are 21 become 30 and 40 and their parents become 60 and 70? What do we do when? The IEP must become the organic document that it was intended to be, rather than simply a form which parents are encouraged to sign by schools as a way to fulfill one of many, many documents. It must be a living document. It must reflect the needs, the abilities of the child, and how best to direct that child as he or she continues in his or her life. In a survey of 732 children who have autism, 84% expressed aspirations to attend college or continuing education in the 14 to 17-year-old category. Almost 80% of those in the 18 to 21 category expressed interest in day programs. 42% of 22 to 45-year-olds in full-time jobs, and 56% in part-time positions. The willingness of youth with autism to involve themselves is there. The challenge before us now is our willingness as a society to express concretely the same willingness to recognize that diversity is not only a matter of race or religion or national origin, but necessarily includes ability as well. We need to encourage greater and deeper collaboration between government and the private sector to support job creation utilizing the abilities and the talents, of all members of our society. We need greater collaboration between government and higher education to encourage our community colleges and four-year universities to develop curriculums offering students courses in working with the disabled, such as Caldwell College in Essex County now offers as well. To create business opportunities for the construction of residences which recognize and meet the needs of youth, young adults, and adults with autism. But most of all, we need to recognize the positive impact that government can and must have in promoting opportunity for all of its citizens. That is the challenge that we must accept in order to fulfill the rightful destiny, not only of our disabled population, but I would argue the promise of America itself and its promise to all of its citizens, no matter who they are. Thank you so very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. We're, first of all, as always, I'm always in awe of what Assemblyman Scheer does. As in my more decades than I care to admit in the field of disability services and policy, I've never met anyone who has been as dedicated and has provided as much public service to people with disabilities as Assemblyman Scheer. And equally very grateful for the work that people like Senator Cunningham, Senator Bono, and Senator Sarlo have done as well. We're going to take a short break, 10-minute break, and reconvene in about 10 minutes. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to introduce someone who I consider a very proactive member of the state legislature. Among the things that Assemblywoman Valerie Huddle will talk about is a bill dealing with collection of data regarding people with disabilities, so she will be able to articulate that much better than I can. We're very fortunate to have her with us today. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Assemblywoman Valerie Huddle.
Thank you and good morning. I see a lot of familiar faces here, and you are the reason why I, in the legislature, as Chair of Human Services, are advocating for your voices every day, for your children, for your family. And I truly hope that, you know, when we talk about human services, it shouldn't be a political issue at all. And it shouldn't be, you know, anybody's right because you're a Democrat. You know, you side with one, and if you're Republican, you side with the others. I'm hoping that together we can create compromise and bipartisanship to help all of our families in the state of New Jersey. With that being said, I do want to thank you, Dr. Bizzurro, and all of you for inviting me to open the statewide summit on disabilities. You know, I'm really pleased that this summit is here today, and it gives me a chance to talk again and discuss the issues, how to improve quality of life for those of us with our families and loved ones with special needs. As I said, as Chair of Human Services, I'm well aware that in order for New Jersey to make real, lasting progress in providing services and opportunities for individuals with developmental disabilities, we need everyone together, the experts, family members, advocates, providers, and government representatives. We must really join together to identify the roadblocks and ways to move past them. You know, for almost 2 years since I've been chair, I've traveled to the state's developmental centers. I've traveled to the group homes, to the private supervised homes, those homes that are equipped for special needs for children and adults, even to the ICFMR facilities. And what I think I found, and it's no surprise to everyone in this room because you certainly are the experts, that there isn't enough housing, there isn't enough programming and assistance for New Jersey's special needs residents and families. But it's certainly not because it's a lack of will on our part, but because it's a lack of long-term planning and adequate funding. Planning and funding. So, again, I'm telling you, I feel I'm preaching to the choir, and you probably know the statistics better than I can recite them, but there are around 10,000 individuals with developmental disabilities still on a waiting list for residential treatment services. And instead of shrinking that number continues to grow over the next decade, and I know that as parents and caregivers, as we grow older and children age out of their special education programs, those numbers will continue to grow. So that's why the state must plan now for the future. So to support that quickly, I'm only going to be a couple of minutes, but I do want to talk about the legislation that I think Dr. Pizzurro asked me to speak about. And that is I call it the data collection bill. And what that is it gathers and it maintains data on individuals with developmental disabilities so that the state can plan for each person and for the entire community collectively. Some of the data to be collected includes needs assessment categories at a minimum by the person's need for residential services, employment or day support services, family support services, medical support services, and behavioral support services. It also requires that the Division of Developmental Disabilities annually notify in writing each individual receiving services of information because as his or her status on the waiting list continues to be on that waiting list and how many people are expected to be served in the next year. So this would be to update the information with DDD about future services and where vital information on programs and opportunities may be accessed. I think that is the roadblock that many of us in this room face. And finally, it requires the Department of Human Services to publish a report annually to be posted on the department's website containing non-identifying aggregate data about eligible persons with developmental disabilities. This is to give the state and providers of services and programs with the information they need to plan ahead. The legislation is A2878 in the Assembly. It passed the committee in both houses in the Assembly, I should say, and it's expected to be passed by the Senate and signed into law very soon. And I think that was the question, where is it today? It passed the Assembly, it passed in the Senate, and we're waiting for it to be signed into law. So for those of you that are interested, please send writings to the governor to try to pass A2878. And lastly, you know, we talk about developmental centers, psychiatric centers, group homes, and independent living. There's certainly enough opinions out there, and we're trying to balance if there is going to be closure, that there is a plan for those individuals in those centers now, that there will be a plan in the community, and that those support services will be offered in the community. To look at this in a more comprehensive way, I'm chairing or co-chairing with Senator Van Drew right now a legislative review panel on the psychiatric centers and the developmental centers. It's bipartisan. It's comprised entirely of legislators from both the Assembly and the Senate, and we're joined together to make long-term planning, and this is certainly a priority in this session, because we're trying to get it done by the end of the year to come up with a blueprint and a white paper. We are hearing now from experts on the developmental disability system, what other states are doing that New Jersey may be able to adopt, and how to increase residential options, housing, and opportunities for special need residents. And I think a key issue that the panel will also take up is to create a stable, permanent funding stream for housing and services. Again, it's about adequate funding. I can go on, and I don't want to take up more time, but again, I'm thrilled to be here because I think it's so important what we do together, and I think that government does provide that safety net. And I always quote this, and it's probably, you've heard it probably, you might hear it another dozen times today, but the quote is, the moral test of a government is how it treats those who are at the dawn of their life, their children, those who are in the twilight of their life, the aged, and those who are in the shadows of life, the sick, the needy, and the disabled. And so I know that everyone in this room today knows that New Jersey certainly passes this moral test of government. And there is no doubt that the state can and must do more to increase the opportunities and options for women, men, and children with developmental disabilities. And I know that this summit proves that. And I am available to any of those that wish to speak to me to continue long-term planning. I've already spoken to a few. And my door is always open. I'm in Englewood, and I'm looking forward to advocating on your behalf, because you are the voices that we need to bring down to Trenton, and that's what I'm here to do. So thank you very much, and thank you, Dr. Pizzurro, for putting this on. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblywoman Huddle. Those of us in the disability field, and I know I am, very proud of the work that Assemblywoman Huddle is doing, and people like Assemblywoman Huddle in the state legislature, constantly bringing proactive policies for people with special needs to the legislature and to the entire state of New Jersey. At this time, I'd like to introduce Ed Hoff from New Jersey Transit. Ed is one of the directors of accessibility services for New Jersey Transit. And I will tell you, they're doing a great job. I've learned over the last 6 years of getting to know people like Ed at New Jersey Transit. And I would say that not being an expert in transportation, but someone from the disability professional field, that what New Jersey is doing in terms of providing accessibility services in terms of mass transit for people with disabilities is ahead of many states. And I honestly believe that we are one of the leaders in providing accessible services for people with New Jersey. But Ed can tell it better than me. Please welcome Ed Hoff from New Jersey Transit.
Good morning. Thank you, Sal. Appreciate the notes. I'm going to begin by talking about the accessible transportation services provided by New Jersey Transit. We have, as many of you know, we have trains, we have buses, we have three light rail systems, and we have something called Access Link, which is our ADA paratransit system. Let me talk a little bit about each one, and very briefly about how they're accessible to people with disabilities. Our bus system. In our bus system, we have over 3,000 buses in New Jersey that are provided by New Jersey Transit or through a contract carrier that's a private carrier but working for us. All 3,000 buses are accessible, meaning that they provide level boarding, that is, they are lift equipped, and there are various other features on the vehicle to accommodate many people with various disabilities, including we have a public address system, obviously. Sometimes we have an automated public address system. We've recently begun that program. Some of our buses in the Hudson County area came through with a system that announces the points along the route to help orient people with visual impairments or people who have difficulty orienting themselves as to where they are. That's a very important feature on the bus that was previously provided manually by the bus operators. That was the requirement anyhow. But at New Jersey Transit, as is in many properties across the country, they became smart about it and said, hey, if we automate this system, we will get very near 100% compliance by providing these automated announcements where we've had some failings in providing them manually in the past. So we've taken that step. We've begun to purchase new buses with automated onboard announcements to help people who need that service. We also did away some years ago with a reservation system. Years ago, if you needed to have a lift-equipped bus, you had to call in the day before. Well, there was only so many buses that had lifts on them, and if you were required to, you couldn't use the stairs on the bus, you'd have to call in. Well, somewhere around 5 or 6 years ago, we started finishing up our program of procuring new buses, and just recently, in the last couple of years, we now have a 100% accessible lift-equipped fleet, thereby negating the need for a reservation. No need for anybody to call up and say, hey, I need a lift-equipped bus. Can you put it on my route on my time tomorrow? Unfortunately, however, we have a couple of major facilities that we go to and come from, namely the Port Authority Bus Terminal in New York City and the George Washington Bridge Terminal. We don't own those facilities, by the way. They're owned by the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey. They have limited accessible gates within their facility so that if a person who has difficulty or it's impossible for them to climb stairs needs to get to that particular gate to board the bus, unfortunately, we have to, what I say sometimes, jump through hoops to get to an accessible gate. So we'll have to use our regular gate to board people, then go around to an accessible gate and pick up anybody there that needs assistance as well. So it's a lot more difficult maneuvering around those facilities. So one part is the vehicle and the other part is the facility. On our bus system, if anybody's traveled through Secaucus Transfer Station, Center Lautenberg Station, you'll notice that the platforms are level with the train car floor, making it a lot easier for anybody, really everybody, to get on board the train via stepping across the threshold rather than having to climb steps on board the train. Of course, that facility also brings people from the street level into the train station or from a bus or from wherever in an accessible manner. There's elevators provided, ramps provided, there are public address systems, there are dynamic signage, the signs that give you information to help you get to your train. Secaucus Transfer Station is one of 76 stations in New Jersey that is accessible. That is, it provides level boarding as I described in Secaucus. New Jersey Transit, prior to the passage of the Americans with Disabilities Act, started an ADA task force that we continue to hold right now. But that task force was charged with developing a couple of plans back in the late 80s and early 90s. And those plans were to determine what stations are key to your system, key in terms of assisting people with disabilities, taking into account ridership was number one. That was the number one parameter of the decision making. Two was proximity to places where people with disabilities would need to come and go from, different healthcare facilities, types like that, or residential areas. And we, back then, although I wasn't part of New Jersey Transit back in the late 80s, early 90s, developed this key station plan and determined that there were 35 key stations that needed to be made accessible by some schedule. Well, today we have 76 stations that are accessible, and I'm pleased to announce that with the completion of the modifications at Ridgewood Station only a couple of weeks ago, that completed our 35 key stations. So, as you can see, in addition to those 35 key stations, we've also made accessible many other stations. Either they were built from scratch, they were built new and new to the system, or they were altered in some manner, requiring them to become accessible. We also were charged, that ADA task force was charged with developing a plan for an ADA paratransit system. That system became known as Access Link, and Access Link, there's a lot of detail behind Access Link, but I'll tell you that it was designed in the ADA to be complementary, not free, but the other type of complementary, to our regular bus service, and particularly the local fixed route bus service. So that wherever the local fixed route bus goes, the Access Link vehicle must also go during the same days and hours. That's usually a source of confusion amongst many people as to what Access Link really is. It's trying to be like the local bus with a small accommodation in that it will deviate off of the fixed route by up to 3/4 mile, but it still travels during the same days and hours and the same general locations as the local fixed route buses. That service is specifically for people with disabilities who have the inability to ride our local fixed route bus service. Very many people ride our local fixed route bus service. It's a great service. You go out to the corner now, as I mentioned before, there's no reservation system. The bus pulls up, you get on the bus, you go to where you gotta go. But of course, not everybody can do that. Well, so it's not just a matter of disability, it's a matter of having a disability that and the inability to ride the local fixed route bus. The only way to cull that out, that little bit of information, is through an interview process. So Access Link, through the Americans with Disabilities Act, conducts interviews to determine eligibility for its service. Access Link has been very successful, and I will agree with Dr. Bizzorro in stating that New Jersey Transit probably has the premier ADA paratransit service in the country. I know it does with our bus service. We're working on making our rail service as best it can be, but our bus service also I consider it a premier service, and Access Link is there as well. We also have 3 light rail systems throughout the state. Not much to do there. Those are 2 of them, actually. The Hudsonburg and Light Rail you may be familiar with, and we have one down called the River Line between Camden and Trenton, which are accessible, and they provide level boarding, automated announcements, and the regular stuff. Being brand new, they were very easy to make accessible. Then we have the challenge of the Newark Light Rail System. There's a light rail system in Newark, formerly known as the Newark City Subway, that runs between Newark Penn Station and a station out near Bloomfield called Grove Street. And about 7 of those stations are accessible because that system was in place long before the ADA, and that's being caught up with now. I don't want to talk too much about the infrastructure in New Jersey Transit, about my title and my position, but there's also another group within New Jersey Transit that deals with accessible transportation, and that's called a local program support unit. They oversee a lot of the programs throughout the state that is other than New Jersey Transit providing accessible transportation. There are county paratransit services, and there are local, municipal, and other types of paratransit services throughout the state. And that unit within New Jersey Transit assists those different systems in accommodating people with disabilities and moving people around the state. There are 2 programs that I want to, well, there's 1 program I really want to talk about as well, that we started in New Jersey Transit about 6 years ago called Travel Instruction. There are, let's see, if anybody's taken public transportation in the room, you probably learned from how to take the bus or how to take the train by somebody showing you the ropes. Your family member, a parent perhaps, taking you on the bus when you were a child and showing you how to do this. For many people, though, that's not good enough. We need a lot more instruction. We need a professional to show us the ropes and how to get around. And travel instruction is something that's emerged in the last 10 years, specifically one-on-one travel instruction for people who need that type of instruction. And it's become a phenomenal service that we at New Jersey Transit have helped to develop, and then we now use it. For people who come through our Access Link eligibility process, we offer them this service. It's completely voluntary. It has nothing to do with their eligibility for Access Link, but they can come and learn how to use the bus or train independently. That's the goal. And we've graduated about 150 people in the last 5 years. Remember now, this is one-on-one instruction. This is not group instruction, so you'll see the numbers are fairly low. But the differences it made in those individuals' lives is tremendous. I've been lucky enough to be present and meet with some of those 150 graduates and to learn what differences it had made in their lives, from transitioning students, which I think are probably the most important group to reach with travel instruction, to seniors. There was, I think our first graduate was somewhere, her age was probably somewhere around 80 years old, and she learned travel instruction, had never been on a bus before in her life, and she said in, I'm trying to remember her quote, I'm going to mess it up a little bit, but she had said that, I'm 80 years old, and this is the first time I've ever been to the mall by myself, independently. And she was like so proud of that accomplishment that 2 months later, when the travel instruction service contacted her to see how she was doing, found out that she was visiting her son in New York by herself, something she hadn't been taught. She learned a skill, she transferred it, was able to use not only the bus system, the train system, the subway system in New York. Her son wasn't too pleased, though, when she showed up unannounced at his apartment in New York, but she was certainly pleased. That travel instruction program, by the way, there are people providing travel instruction, as I mentioned earlier, throughout the state, whether you be a school counselor, a job coach. Many people are providing travel training, I would call that. I would categorize that as travel training. It's for people who can just need an orientation on how to use the system. But for people who need this added level of instruction, there are some specialists around the state and across the country. If you go to a website called, I think it's ATI.org, it's the Association of Travel Instructors. This is a group that has the philosophy that you need to be trained in order to train others on how to travel. And we are lucky enough to have a couple of groups within the state that have this specialty, and that's the one that we at New Jersey Transit employ to train those that want to volunteer to go through the training can. But we need that training to spread to other groups throughout the state. We need that expertise that they have to spread throughout the state. They do train the trainer programs, and there's a lot of that going on, and we need to endorse that and see that go around the state. Right now, the program that we run through Access Link is only available in 7 counties throughout New Jersey, the Bergen Passaic area and northward. Slightly southward toward Morris, Essex, Somerset, and Union counties. Hudson, Bergen, Passaic are the others. But that program is, not only do they do individual instruction, for us they do individual instruction, but there's group instruction for those that could better learn through group instruction. There's all different types that they have available, and I hope that program expands. The other thing I want to talk about, though, is the we all know that transportation is a vital link to get people with disabilities to wherever they're going, from housing to the community to shopping to whatever you need to do. You often hear that the major issues for people with disabilities is housing and transportation and employment. Absolutely true. Well, New Jersey Transit and a lot of these other smaller programs throughout the state on the municipal and county levels have accessible vehicles, have been properly trained, it's improving every day, but have all of those elements. Sometimes what's missing, however, is the connection from the residential unit to the community and, of course, en route to the transportation system. I know of a few developments, and there's probably many more that I'm completely unaware of throughout the state, that were built mostly for senior housing, where there is no connection to the community. They're self-contained communities. We have everything you need in this one community, and that's great. You don't have to leave the community unless you want to. And they sometimes provide their own transportation. I'm talking mostly about the for-profits that provide 55 and over housing. Well, sometimes you want to leave your community and go to, perhaps your doctor. Your doctor's not going to be living in your community in all cases. And that transportation that may be provided by your development may not be able to take you there. You may have to take a taxi or some other form of service. Maybe you can take Access Link. Maybe you're too far out and there's no service available. We need to ensure that developments or any type of housing that we provide has at least a physical connection to public transportation. We find that some places it's non-existent. Within the community, there's plenty of sidewalks, and you can get around and visit your neighbors, but there's no actual connection to the public right-of-way, and that's sometimes all that's necessary to get you to public transportation that'll then make the link over to the community and get you other services. So I don't exactly know how to accomplish that except to make it known that whenever we look at residential areas for people with disabilities and we say, yeah, we want to know where transportation is, transportation should be that part right at the beginning. Let's decide where this is. Transportation doesn't normally come after the resident is already in place. Transportation has to be there first. So let's look to that before we develop, certainly, new housing. But if we're going to place somebody, let's look at that as well. I just want to say in closing that the travel instruction program I talked about and the programs that are available at New Jersey Transit and throughout the state, all the services are available, are stressed, especially all the local programs, the county programs, the municipal programs. And when they get stressed, we feel their stress. And there needs to be a greater involvement to provide greater funding to these local paratransit operations. And I hope that all of you will join me in helping make that happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. There are, besides Ed, I think there's another person from New Jersey Transit, the accessibility group here. If you have time today, actually we're going to take a break and another break in about a minute, just give them a chance to set up for lunch. But if you have a chance informally to talk to the people from New Jersey Transit and what's happening regarding accessibility services, I think it's really incredible. And I meet with them once a month during our ADA task force meetings, and I'm always amazed every month in terms of what they're doing, especially in the times of when the fiscal climate has become very difficult. I think we're providing outstanding services for people with disabilities in New Jersey. As I mentioned, if you have a chance to talk to them, please do informally. We're going to take another break to give them a chance, again, maybe 10 minutes. Give me a chance to set up for lunch, and we'll do that. And we'll meet back here shortly. We are very fortunate this morning. Senator Jennifer Beck from the 12th Legislative District is with us. Following her career, although I don't live in her part of New Jersey, I know she's been very proactive regarding the issues we talked about this morning. So again, we're very fortunate, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce State Senator Jennifer Beck.
Thank you, and good morning. Good morning. Good morning. I might just give a little background about how it is that I became personally involved in the issues of the developmentally disabled. It was back in 2007, and I received a phone call, a very panicked phone call, from a local family that lives in Little Silver in Monmouth County. And the call was in regards to the fact that their first cousin had been taken to the emergency room of the hospital. And the story went like this. This young woman's name was Tara O'Leary. Her mother died when she was very young. Her father cared for her throughout her teens, and at some point he did remarry, but became very, very ill, and he too passed, leaving her in the hands of the state of New Jersey. Her stepmother was thought to have had guardianship. We later found out that she had refused to take on that role. So as Tara was taken into a skilled sponsor home, and the family, the cousins and the aunts and the uncles that had come to know and love their cousin, Tara O'Leary, throughout their lives, celebrated the holidays with her and spent time as she was going through her schooling, that they were isolated from her, and that a caseworker named Bridget Grimes told the family that the guardian did not want Tara to have any visitors, which turned out later to be a lie. They also followed through with the Department of Human Services to say, you know, we haven't seen our cousin in 2 years. We don't understand why anyone wouldn't want us to spend some time with her and visit with her and maybe take her out to lunch. And so eventually, the caseworker, Bridget Grimes, acquiesced and said, okay, you can see her once a month where I tell you. You can see her at the municipal building or at the library, because the skilled sponsor, Deborah Sloan, doesn't want you at the house. She's too busy. So they proceeded to meet and see Tara wherever this caseworker would allow. Half the time she was late, half the time she didn't show up. It was a 2-hour drive for the family to go visit their cousin. But they persisted, and once a month, they did whatever it took to make sure that they got a chance to see Tara. But they noticed change. They noticed change in Tara's physical appearance, and it came to a head one day in the fall when she arrived disheveled, clearly not washed, shoes on the wrong feet, diapers duct taped to her body, hair falling out, in a baby carriage. She was a 28-year-old woman. The aunt, obviously alarmed, called the Department of Human Services, expressed fear and concern for her well-being, and was told that she simply didn't understand because Tara had old age disease. And as a result of that, the caseworker, Bridget Grimes, took her to the physician who had been examining her for many years. And the physician said, she's fine. Gave her a clean bill of health, even though at that point, Tara weighed 42 pounds. Right. As we looked further, that at that point, the caseworker, I think, must have felt that the family, because they were becoming so vocal, that there was going to be a problem. And she was supposed to have been taking Tara to her day program. Tara was supposed to report 5 days a week to the ARC of Hunterdon County. In the course of 2 years, she was only there 17 times. And for whatever reason, Bridget Grimes decided to take her right after she had this physical exam. And when the ARC saw her, they knew something was wrong, and they refused to allow Tara to go back to the sponsor home. As it turned out, Tara was so malnourished, and at this point, her skin would tear just to touch it. And we became involved because there was no guardian to make medical decisions. In the state of New Jersey, when my Senate office called and asked for them to intervene and give the aunt guardianship, the state said, well, that'll take a week. And we said, we don't have a week. This young woman is dying. And they said, we'll get back to you. And so then 3 days later, they did get back to us, but the physician that was supposed to sign the paperwork forgot to sign it. At which point we said, if you have to take it in your teeth to the physician, you will get his signature by the end of the day. This woman is dying. And with those stern words, they actually reacted, but it is my feeling that should never have had to happen. As more investigation was done and the Hunterdon County Prosecutor's Office became involved, we found out that both Aaron Germain and Tara O'Leary had been locked in a bedroom with a reverse lock and starved to death. Aaron weighed 38 pounds and Tara weighed 40. They were allowed to crawl around the room in their fecal matter. And the Lydia Joy, who was living with them, was an older woman and higher functioning, had been complaining to her family week after week about the fact that at night she couldn't sleep because Tara and Aaron were screaming. When the family called the Department of Human Services, the department said, that's just how Tara communicates. That was the response. When we looked at the IHPs, individual health plans for Tara, it included things like she's going to take piano lessons this year. She was never able to play the piano, even in her younger years. Any supervisor that would have looked at that document would have known, if someone had looked, that that was an impossibility. Her personal needs count was used to purchase things like a jungle gym, clogs, size 10 clothing. Tara never weighed more than 110 pounds. She was never wearing size 10. And so the abuse of this young woman and her roommate, Aaron, who actually survived, became a story that I became intimately familiar with. And as we worked with the Hunterdon County Prosecutor's Office, and by the way, they're interesting outcomes. One is that while Bridget Grimes and Deborah Sloan were indicted, Bridget went to Pennsylvania and continued caring for people with developmental disabilities. She was recently, she pled guilty to, I believe, 11 counts last week, and she will be spending time in jail as a result of her actions. And Deborah Sloan is next. She was the skilled sponsor who had a refrigerator stuffed so full with food that you couldn't even close it, and she allowed these two women to starve. Lydia Joy, who, as I said, was a higher functioning woman with developmental disabilities, who actually was forced oftentimes to care for Tara and Aaron, was transferred out of Deborah Sloan's home to another skilled sponsor home where she was abused and passed. So she went from one bad situation to another only to have a horrible result in that she died. And so as this particular case got a lot of public attention, my legislative office became inundated with phone calls from parents and family across the state of New Jersey about the plight of a group of people that really have no voice and that often are finding themselves in the situation that their caretakers are their torturers. The people that are supposed to be their advocates are people that are holding them as prisoners. And that, to me, and I apologize for any members of the Department of Human Service because I can't obviously cast the broad net and say everybody is the same as those that I dealt with, but that the system's broken. And the way that the organizations are functioning now, and particularly I think our Department of Human Services, there is an incentive to turn and look the other way. And one of the things that I know I'm taking a lot of time, maybe more than I should, but I felt one of the reasons I wanted to be here today is because I've learned, and I've heard the many voices from parents and so forth, and that I want you to know that we are taking action. We, after the investigation began, we also had many things that occurred that I felt were not appropriate. The special response unit that was tasked with investigating this case rewrote their report 16 times before it was released to the parents. Documents were being shredded in opposition to the prosecutor's requests, even though those documents had not reached the 7-year mark at what point in time they can be shredded. There were many things that happened that made me feel personally that the system is broken. We have legislation which I don't say is perfect, but it is a start, that we are calling Tara's Law, which requires that the caseworkers will not have so much autonomy and power. One of the things that I view as a failure of the system is that in this case, the caseworker was the source of information for the department. And so the department, in order to try to make sure that it wasn't liable, it's much easier to believe that they're doing the right thing than to go and check and see if they are doing the right thing. There was a very hands-off system of management from the supervisor for Bridget Grimes. And I think they ultimately found that this caseworker controlled the family, the family's access to this young woman, the skilled sponsor. To some degree, what Bridget Grimes said and did allowed Deborah Sloan to continue serving as a foster parent for these three women, and that has to change. It's not so different from what we saw with Dyfus, except for that we don't have the laws in place to punish in the same ways that we do for children that are abused, for those that are developmentally disabled. I'm happy to share my legislation with you. I welcome your input because, of course, as much time as I personally have invested in this issue, I certainly have not served in the department or as a social worker, so I obviously, I'm not a parent of a child that has these challenges, so I welcome your thoughts and input. Senate President Steve Sweeney and I were successful in getting the registry bill signed into law, which allows the reporting of those that have abused folks to be included on a registry so that potential employers can look onto the registry and see if there have been past cases of abuse before they hire somebody. That's a start, a small movement forward. There's a lot more that has to be done in our system of care for the developmentally disabled. And I thank you for your time today.
Thank you, Senator Beck. As I mentioned, not living in Senator Beck's part of the state, over the last couple of years, I've read a lot about her when she was in the Assembly and since she's gotten to the Senate. And she's been very proactive regarding these issues and regarding issues, as we just heard now, regarding the civil rights of people with developmental disabilities and the human rights. I really appreciate it, Senator Beck. I really appreciate your comments. John Adair, who I got to know via the telephone, the email, the last few weeks, is president of the New Jersey Council on Special Transportation. And he alerted me recently to some of the issues, some of the regional issues regarding people with disabilities and ability to access mass transit. And he asked if he could have an opportunity to share those issues and those concerns with us as a group, and we're very happy to have him. So please welcome John Adair.
Thank you, Sal. New Jersey Council of Special Transportation, just a little bit what that is. It's a organization made up of county agencies, nonprofit, for-profit, also attended with New Jersey Transit. We're an advocacy group, an educational group, to help advocate for transportation for seniors, those with disabilities, and the disadvantaged. When asked at different functions, people ask what's the most important thing to them. One is independence, and number two, most of the time, is transportation. And knowing that, that's the common denominator. When I came in here today, and again, thank you, Sal, for letting me come here, I started recognizing the faces from the different disability organizations. Linda Fiddle, who you're going to hear from shortly, from the autism community. Chris Ward, who's with the Visionary Group. So it's a one common denominator amongst everything is transportation. And to get to independence, guess what? They need the transportation. I want to recognize Ed Hoff and with him Ronnie Sirianni from Access Link. They do a great job, Access Link. The problem is if you don't live along a bus route to use that complimentary service, you're dependent upon community transit or your local transportation organizations. Yearly, those organizations, through casino revenue funding, federal grants, local funding, supply over 5 million rides to seniors, those with disabilities, and the disadvantaged in this state. Earlier this year, we've finally realized with the decrease in all these different funding sources, especially casino revenue, which for the longest time was the biggest source of funding for transportation in the state, is declining. I mean, it's not just declining a little bit, it's declining and it's an issue. We have to start looking at other ways of funding the service that's needed. Back in the beginning of this year, the New Jersey Council of Special Transportation put out a statement publicly. New Jersey's Human Services Community Transportation is in a serious financial crisis, which is affecting every county, municipality, and social service agency in the state. This crisis negatively impacts New Jersey's older adult population, persons with disabilities, economically disadvantaged, veterans, and other transportation-dependent persons. Because of that, we're developing a white paper that's going to be sent out to the state legislators, federal legislators, because this is just a state issue. We're talking about federal and to authorities that could possibly, one, help with the, to address the crisis. And with this white paper, hopefully give them options on what to look at to give us money to do this service. So today, back at the registration desk, there is a copy of a draft of an executive summary that's going to go along with the white paper. So if you didn't get it, please get it. And make sure you reach out once you do read it to, the authorities, your legislators, and help support this cause.
Thanks, Ed.
Thank you, John. This afternoon, following lunch, a big focal point of our meeting will deal with autism. And through Assemblyman Scheer, and as we were planning for this meeting, for this summit, I was contacted by Linda Fiddle. And Linda Fiddle is the executive director of the Daniel Jordan Fiddle Foundation dealing with autism. And as I mentioned this morning, I've been in this field of disability services and disability policy for more decades than I care to remember. And in fact, I mentioned this also to one of the people representing Bergen County this morning. I'm still being educated as to the services that are available, not only in New Jersey, but right here in my own backyard in Bergen County. One of them is the Daniel Jordan Fiddle Foundation. Linda Fiddle is here, and she's going to share with us. Linda, are you here, by the way? Linda is going to share with us basically what the Daniel Jordan Fiddle Foundation is about and what it does. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for
for being here today. The Daniel Jordan Fiddle Foundation is a national autism organization named for my son Danny, who passed away over a decade ago, and he was a child living with autism. And during his lifetime, I realized, and this is going back 12, 13 years ago now, that there were few, if any, programs here in New Jersey and in the national programming for adults living with autism. And as we parents do, when our children are attaining adolescence, we start to think about what are they going to do as an adult. And so when Danny was 9, I was thinking about that. And after he passed away, I really decided that I was going to focus on this question of what was going to happen to my child living with autism when he became an adult living with autism. So during the past decade, our organization has co-developed and developed and initiated programs throughout New Jersey and throughout the United States that are focused on all aspects of adult life, residential, recreational, all kinds of recreational, art, horseback riding, anything that you and I would like to do, people living with autism like to do, employment, educational, residential, and we work with service providers around the country. And what we're doing now is we are taking these programs and blueprinting them, creating replicable models so that the wheel does not have to be reinvented over and again, and it can be a starting point for grassroots communities everywhere to address the growing population of adults living with autism. And now it's estimated that there are 1 in 100 people in our United States who live with autism spectrum disorders. So we need, as a country and as the state of New Jersey, to be focusing on what is going to happen to these children as they're aging up to adult life, as I was concerned over a decade ago for my son Danny. I was very struck today by a quote that you all have on the back of the programming. Society's accumulated myths and fears about disability and disease are as handicapping as the physical limitations that flow from the actual impairment. It is my view as a member of the National Board of Directors, also of the Autism Society of America, and on national steering committees, working closely with Senator Menendez on the recent reauthorization of the Combating Autism Act, that we as a country, we as a state, need to create more awareness about the strengths, talents, and potentials of people living with autism and other challenges. People are people first. Their challenges are part of who they are, but they're not who they are. And we need to create public awareness. So my biggest point these days in terms of advocacy is creating that awareness. And I believe here in New Jersey, there are several legislators here today in the room, that we need to take some of the New Jersey, for instance, ad campaign budget and put it towards a positive ad campaign showing the strengths and talents of people living with disabilities. If we can do that, I believe we can open the door for people with all different kinds of challenges, because prospective employers will be saying, gee, I could hire that person, or residential communities and residential group homes, whatever we want in our communities for people living with challenges. Well, some communities are opposed to that. If we opened a door by creating a positive ad campaign that showed what great citizens, what great neighbors, what great potential people living with all kinds of challenges have, I believe more doors and more opportunities would be open. So my final thought here is, let's consider that as an idea. Let's bring these ideas into our communities, share them, work together collaboratively, and let's create great futures for all people living with disabilities. Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you, Linda. You know, I really need to thank, in addition to the Hall Institute of Public Policy, I'd really like to thank the co-sponsors of this conference who are mentioned in your program. and I'd like to give them some attention. And I'm just wondering, first of all, starting with our wonderful sign language interpreters, if Ms. Sherwood and Katie could stand up and just be recognized for a second. They have gracefully provided the sign language interpreters and to help to make this this symposium possible. Also, the person who is providing, we have someone who's serving as an aide for those with physical disabilities. We have an aide available, and I should have introduced her this morning, but if she could just stand up and be recognized. I don't know if, And she's actually being provided, the director of the home health care services of Bergen County has left, but she was here earlier, and she has very graciously provided those services for us today as a volunteer. I'd like to also thank other people who have come to help out in some way. Patricia Caggiano, who's at the registration desk, provides services and consulting services for people with disabilities, and I'd like you to recognize her. My colleague, Carol Sevely from New York. Carol, if you would stand up for a second, who provides wonderful counseling services and legal services for parents of people with disabilities in the state of New York. I'd like to thank Carol for being here. Also, I'd like to thank the people from Rutgers Law School, and if professors Canty Barnes and Professor Valverde could stand up and just be recognized for a second. Professors Canty Barnes and Professor Valverde have a special ed clinic at Rutgers Law School, and they train attorneys and supervise them in training. I understand that the Office of Administrative Law and Superior Court, is that correct? So they're doing a great job in preparing people who eventually will be representing people with disabilities in basically in education and hopefully in other services. And as I mentioned very early this morning, as I'm still being educated as we go along, I once worked in Washington for members of the Congress on the IDEA, as I mentioned to people this morning, and I thought I knew everything 30 years ago when I was doing that on Capitol Hill about disability policy. And it's amazing that 30 years later, I'm finding out that we still have people with disabilities who have difficulty acquiring appropriate housing, acquiring appropriate health care, have difficulty, although I think we're making great strides, have difficulty just getting around the community, accessing transportation, to get to a doctor, to go shopping, to engage in social activities. And as I mentioned also earlier this morning, we have people with disabilities with 3 times the unemployment rate of the non-disabled population. By the way, I was talking to Dr. Canty Barnes about some of the studies that Frank Rush at Penn State and I have done over the years, and I forgot to mention, and I'll share with you now, one of our studies dealing with the employment of people with disabilities dealt with professionals, dealt with people with medical degrees, medical doctors, people with MBAs from Harvard Business School. And we found that that group was also many times more likely to be unemployed, even with professional degrees from the best professional schools in the country, University of Chicago. And we made a list of those people. And we found it to be startling, because I thought that was the one group that, regardless of disability, still would be highly recruited. And we took it, we took that particular study after we started collecting our data to some of the people at Columbia University and Columbia Business School. And we found that there were 2 lawsuits by 2 people with overt disabilities from Columbia Business School. And interesting, I went to graduate school at Columbia University. It's where I got my doctorate. And when I was there, I found that the students at both the law school and the business school were highly recruited. Some of them never even filed applications. They were recruited by Wall Street long before they graduated. And yet these particular students not only were not recruited, they could not get their foot in the door for a job interview. I'm talking people who are quadriplegic, but academically were doing very well. So although I think we've made great strides over these past 30 years, we still have a long way to go, and that's why we're here today. We're going to, you can sit tight or take a quick break. You're going to set up for lunch. We have our, we're actually going to have two speakers at lunch, and then we're going to have a long discussion after lunch and two speakers regarding both children and adult disabilities. So we're going to take a break for, I guess, not more than another 10 minutes or so. Thank you. Mary Getford, who's with the New Jersey Office of Emergency Management, who's scheduled to speak a little later, is going to give her presentation on emergency preparedness for people with disabilities. So we'll do that now. So please welcome Mary.
Okay, thank you for having me here, and thank you for inviting me. I know Kelly Ruba was supposed to be here, and she's, many of you know her. She's been an advocate and now works for the Division of Developmental Disabilities, and she's just excellent. So I have some big shoes to fill, but I'll try and do that in a good kind of a way. As was stated, my name is Mary Gepfert. I'm the External Affairs Officer for the State Office of Emergency Management, and I am also the Access and Functional Needs Liaison, and I'll talk to you about what that term means. But I've been involved with emergency management in the state for 24 years. I'd like to tell you I started when I was 12, but that's not really the case. I have been around for a while. And have been involved most of that time with either external affairs work or training. I've spent many years in training, and also been doing the work with access and functional needs populations for over 5 years now. So it's been a privilege to work with these groups and work with the advocates, and I still have a lot to learn, but hopefully I'll be able to share some useful information with you here today. I want to talk to you about what that term access and functional needs means in terms of emergency management and disaster planning policy and disaster planning endeavors. So we'll go over that. We'll talk about emergency planning from a couple of different perspectives, and we'll talk about some projects that we're involved in from the State Office of Emergency Management with the disability community. If I could ask a question first off, and that would be, how many of you here are involved in any type of disaster planning in some way with your organizations? All right, not too bad. I'm glad a few of you out there are involved in that. I hope I'll encourage more of you to become involved with that by the end of this talk. How many here were impacted in some way by Hurricane Irene? Okay, more hands go up. So as a result of Hurricane Irene, hopefully the planning and preparation question will take care of itself as time unfolds. Before I get into the heart of the talk, I do want to tell you that every single county in New Jersey received a disaster declaration for Hurricane Irene. So if you have consumers, or you're aware of consumers, or you yourself or your family or friends were impacted by the hurricane, you need to tele-register with FEMA before the end of the month. That's very important, because once October 31st comes and goes, you'll no longer be able to access any assistance from FEMA. So I have flyers in the back with just information about that, but the tele-registration number is 1-800-621-FEMA, or you can also go online at www.disasterassistance.gov. And over half of the folks in New Jersey that have tele-registered have done so online. We have almost 70,000 individuals who have teleregistered for assistance for Hurricane Irene. The eligibility rate is close to 70%, and that's very high. And FEMA has approved about $116 million so far in aid. For those of you that are working with individuals who receive federal or state benefits of any kind, disaster assistance does not impact those benefits. If they are a senior citizen, if they have a disability, if they're receiving any type of benefit, is not impacted by disaster assistance. So if people have unmet needs and they are afraid to teleregister because they think their benefits are going to be impacted, that is not the case. If you are a private nonprofit organization who performs a critical function that the government would serve otherwise, typically this is education, medical care, things of that nature, you may be, and you're impacted by Irene, you may be eligible to apply for a public assistance grant for needs, for expenses not met by insurance. So if anyone is in that position, they should look into that. If they are not eligible, the Small Business Administration has a loan rate of 3% right now. So again, there's information on that on the back table. So just, you could take a look at that if you want. But I just wanted to make sure before we got into it that we could get the recovery, and I could make just a little advertisement for recovery and do some outreach. If you are aware of anyone with a disability who has been impacted by Irene and has unmet needs as a result of that storm, please call 211 or have them call 211, and we will make sure that we can find the proper resources to assist them. Okay, this is regarding Irene related unmet needs. We're trying to do some outreach. We've connected with a lot of agencies, but I do have concerns about individuals that are not served by agencies and maybe living independently in the community and not necessarily receiving any services and having some unmet needs, whether it be housing, accessible housing, or whatever that is that's been impacted by Irene. We'd like to be able to get them involved in the recovery process as soon as possible and get them on their way. So I also put that out there. The folks at 211 will refer those calls to me or to someone that can assist. We are going to have disaster casework managers coming into the state that are going to assist with some of the long-term recovery needs. We have about 130 families that have maxed out on their FEMA grants. So this was a very serious storm, and there is going to be some complex long-term recovery needs attached to it. But in terms of people with disabilities, I really want to try to do some outreach here. If there are people that you're aware of that do have unmet needs, let's try to get those needs met, and let's try to make sure that no one falls through the cracks if possible. Okay, what do we mean by this term, access and functional needs, in terms of disaster planning? We used to, about 5 years ago, we used the term special needs or special needs planning for disasters, or how does disaster planning of emergency management impact people with special needs? Well, we found out that the term special really was not that special. It was not appreciated. It really didn't cover what we wanted to cover, and it wasn't specific enough. So, we've adopted the terminology that is used by FEMA in reference to its whole community planning efforts. And what that means is they want to make sure that emergency plans reflect and include and have participation by all community members and all groups in the community. And obviously that includes a disability community as well. So why do we use this term access and functional needs? Well, the first reason is it is one of the goals of the New Jersey Office of Emergency Management are resilient communities, prepared citizens, engaged citizens in emergency preparedness, and a concerted effort to try to reach populations that may be vulnerable in when disaster strikes. Every life matters. Every life matters. No matter what your disability is or what your issue is, we want to try to make sure you're included in those emergency plans. We have made great strides in that way, but we also have a way to go. We're cognizant of that, and we're working with many community groups out there to get that done, and I'll talk to you a little bit about how we do that. The idea of functional needs relates to how can a person function in a pre- and post-disaster environment? Can they take the steps that are necessary to prepare? Can they follow evacuation orders? Can they take shelter on their own? Can they evacuate without assistance? So all of that, we look at not a person's medical diagnosis or if they're, quote, disabled or, quote, not disabled or where they are checked off on a box, but what is their ability to function in that disaster environment? And we have to make sure that we are addressing the functional needs. We want to make sure that all individuals in the community have access to programs, benefits, emergency preparedness information, everything that is out there involving the disaster. Do they have appropriate access, and do they have the access that they need? So when we say access and functional needs, that's what we mean by access. Also, integration. Are individuals able to be integrated into emergency plans, into shelters, you know, into all the physical and safety mechanisms that are set up in the disaster, pre- and post-disaster environment? So we want to make sure there's, number one, access, number two, integration. Number three, we definitely look at the Americans with Disabilities Act in terms of civil rights, and civil rights to us are human rights, but with those rights also come responsibilities. So it's not just the government's responsibility for emergency preparedness, but it's also the responsibility of the individual to the extent that they are able, and service providing agencies to be on board with this as well. So it is not just one, the term sometimes used is like a three-legged stool, and each leg has to be there in order for that stool to function. But we look at rights, we also look at responsibilities. And now in some planning sectors, health, for instance, the health arena uses the term at-risk populations. Special, we're moving away from that. The other reason for that is because we don't want to say, well, we're going to make one set of plans for this population and then a special set of plans for another population. Special does not always equal equality or equal the same thing. So we want to make sure that we're just doing it for everybody and including everybody from the onset, and that's our normal course of business. Sometimes FEMA, my counterpart of FEMA is Marcy Roth. She works directly for the FEMA director on disability integration issues, and she uses the term baked in rather than icing on the cake. So that's an image maybe to put out there as baked in. So what are these functional needs that we look at and try to be cognizant of in our emergency plans? The first is communication. Can the individual see, hear, and even read the information that is coming out? Many years ago, I worked in an adult literacy program, and I don't recall the statistics from back then, but on this disaster, I had the opportunity to see some reviews on literacy and whether we're able to reach populations that have low or no literacy, and about a quarter of our population in the country falls into a category of having low or no literacy. So, well, in terms of communication, when we give directions simply, clearly, directly, and telling people what to do, how to do it in kind of a concise way, and give them the information that they need in various formats, we cover a lot of communication needs. So what accommodations that we make for the disability community also is helping others that maybe do not have disabilities or have other issues. So communication. Can an individual, if their expressive speech is, if they have an issue with their expressive speech, one of the preparedness measures maybe that they should think about doing is having an information card on them about their disability and a little bit about themselves. That way, if they encounter a first responder, they can present the card or information card, and that responder will know right away what is going on in a situation that's probably going to be high risk and very hurried. So that's an example of that. So we look at communication. The second is transportation. Do we have accessible transportation? Not only evacuating out, but coming back in. So we look at transportation accessible. We also look at people that do not have their own vehicle. And do we have the proper public transportation set up for them to evacuate? The third area of concern is medical. Individuals with medical concerns need help from medical professionals. This is not the category of people that maybe rely on personal care assistance or other types of help, family members. These are folks that need attention from medical professionals. They need to be evacuated to medical needs shelters. We did have that capability going on during Irene. That was happening. Supervision is one of the functional needs that we address, and we look at number one, minor children under the age of 18 do sometimes get separated from parents during their disasters for a period of time. We look at that, and how can we take care of them in the interim, and then how do we reunite them with their parents? We look at individuals who may have a disability where they need some supervision. Do we have security in our shelter so people do not elope or wander off, or can they be in a secure area? And the last is maintaining independence. And I know I'm speaking to the choir here when I say that people maintain independence in many ways, whether it be through assistive technologies or medication or aids or an accessible house or residence, whatever they have. But we want to try to make sure that that individual is still able to maintain their independence during the disaster, and then after the disaster and through the recovery period. We don't want people who were independent to become dependent back on the system. We want people that are independent, want to make sure that they remain so to the best extent possible. So when we talk about access and functional needs planning, that's what we mean. It's not, well, does this person have a disability or they don't have a disability, or, you know, they're 65, so they're a senior citizen, and what about them? No, this is what we look at, these areas. And it's a rather large umbrella, but we find out that when we address these concerns, we address concerns for a large, large portion of the population. So that's why these things have to be looked at. The planning strategy for all of this, in terms of government agencies, should involve, and this is state, county, local, should involve emergency management, health, and human services officials. All three of those agencies within government need to be involved. If they are not involved, if all three are not involved, it's not going to work. Each type of agency brings a different skill set to the table that's needed in this type of planning. So you need to make sure at least those three agencies are involved. In terms of the bigger picture, we need to have the individual involved in emergency planning. We need to have the government, obviously. And we also need to have agencies which serve people with functional needs involved in continuity, business continuity planning. Now, that photograph that you see there, that was a drill or an exercise for a medical needs shelter in Atlantic County, which they did open during Hurricane Irene. So that's an example of a specialized cot that the Department of Health bought for some counties in the South region, which was forward thinking because they did come to use. FEMA, I understand, has just authorized specs for universal cot, which is going to be able to serve many needs in shelters. All right, what are the issues and what are the planning assumptions for the disability community? About 18 to 20% of the population self-identifies on the census data as disabled. We try to tell our emergency management coordinators that. In some areas, that's going to be a little higher. In some areas, it's going to be a little lower. It just kind of depends on age and other different factors that crop up. Evacuation times for these populations are longer. Post-disaster housing is very challenging. I have a case that I'm working with right now to try to find a family an accessible home. It's taken over a couple of weeks. They've been evacuated from their accessible home. It was impacted during the storm. They're probably not going to be in it for 6 months to a year because there's an issue with the foundation. And it's very challenging. I don't have to tell you about accessible housing. I'm sure you know what the various issues are with that. But that's can be a big problem. Non-typical resources are needed. This did come up in the shelter operations that we had after Irene. We were able to address those by using resources from the Department of Human Services developmental centers. They drew on those resources that they had. Some counties had caches. The Department of Health has funded equipment caches. My office has funded some smaller caches, not to the extent that the Health Department has, but we drew on what we had. And for the most part, from what we can see, we were able to meet the needs in the shelters. I know that many of you were without power for a long time. This impacts these groups highly, and preparation, a lot of problems did come into place because of the power outages extending for a period of time. The preparation for this can vary. We'll talk a little bit about that. Depends on what kind of resources are available in the household and, you know, that kind of thing. But I think you can see power can go out for long periods of time, and it's a deep concern in a disaster situation. Okay, the individual. Now, I also in the back have a brochure for individuals with disabilities. I'm not going to go deep into that, but And is everybody kind of aware of the standard readiness steps for disaster? We've been putting that out to you for a while, general population and the disability community, but to be able, number one, try to have some situational awareness. Pay attention to things like the weather and try to anticipate what the impacts of that could be. Now, one way that we promote situational awareness among agencies is I'm involved with a group called the New Jersey Special Needs Advisory Panel, and we have a couple members here. Tom Brady's here, Grady, I'm sorry, and Jason Weiland is here. And if there's anyone else here from the SNAP and I didn't see you, I apologize, but those were the two that I saw. But there's some associations on there, state agencies, people at the bottom line that have the ability to be amplifiers of the message. So during the week prior to Irene, or if there's a snowstorm or anything that I can anticipate, and usually with weather you have some predictions, we try to push out the situational awareness messages. This is what's going to happen. These are the impacts that it could have. With Irene, I sent out some very direct, pointed messages about you're going to be without power. You're going to be without personal care assistance. You might get evacuated. Agencies are going to get impacted. This is the first disaster that I have seen where I've gotten a lot of reports back about agencies need to be, I have to take a little break here, okay. All right, I'm gonna step aside. There's somebody waiting to speak, and then I will, I'm gonna return, or?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Break.
Yeah. Forgive me for these changes in the scheduling as we move along. Assemblywoman Connie Wagner is here, and she has a very tough schedule. So she would like to extend greetings, and then she has to go on to a meeting, and then we'll continue with Mary's presentation, and we'll follow that up after Mary with our presentation on autism. Okay.
Please welcome Mr. State Assemblyman one at a
time. Good afternoon, and thank you for allowing me to say hello, and hope that this symposium works well for all of you, and you walk away with all of the information that you need. I need to tell you that there is one man in this room who truly did awaken me as to the needs of people with disabilities, and that is Jim Thieberry. And Jim, from the County Office of Disabilities, rooked me in a long time ago to tell me everything that was needed. And at that time, I was a council member in Paramus and then later became a freeholder. But listening to Jim, and he involved me in all of the activities, he got me involved in the Access for All, which I managed to bring to our community in Paramus. Now, the one thing that I figured out was it was disturbing to me how hard it is to get local officials to embrace Access for All. They all say yes, and then when it comes down to doing something, it very rarely goes anyplace. So recognizing this, I thought, well, I can't do this because I just become the crazy lady that sees this as being very, very important. I need to find someone in the community that could take on this battle for me. And I did. So I found a woman whose child had severe autism, and she decided to go to work in the town. So the first thing that she set up to do was to provide swimming lessons for children with autism. Sounds easy, sounds simple. She wrote a grant, she did all the work. It was not easy. She had to fight every inch of the way, and sometimes in tears, but she managed to get it through. And what she was doing was not only teaching swimming, that wasn't her main goal, it was also to provide the sensitivity to the lifeguards so that they knew that when they had to reprimand a child, that maybe that child wasn't hearing or able to respond. So it worked for both the lifeguards, management, and the children with disabilities. So she took up that fight. Now, knowing that I had this woman now connected, I needed her for another fight. And this is one that we're working on, and I think it's going to work. And we recognize that we have to put people with disabilities to work. We all know that the unemployment rate is, in New Jersey, I think 9.4%. Across the nation, it's not good. So what can we do in our little world to make sure that people with disabilities have the right to work? Because there are too many doors that I knock on, and I see the 80-year-old grandmother taking care of the 40-year-old granddaughter with disabilities, the 60-year-old mother that's out working, and I know what everybody is thinking, what is going to happen? So we now have a company that's willing to donate a greenhouse, and I don't mean a little small little greenhouse, I'm talking the Disney kind of greenhouse, that now I'm looking for property to put this greenhouse on so that we can put people to work. And they will be growing vegetables and flowers to be sold to the grocery stores. This is working in different states. We want it to come to New Jersey. So now the only thing I need is to find a piece of land, which we're working on right now, to make this happen. The only thing I'm doing is facilitating the meeting. So sitting on Human Services, and I sit with Chairman Valerie Venieri Huddle, who's doing a phenomenal job, and I have to tell you, it's been sometimes discouraging, it's been sometimes frustrating, because I hear the needs, I know what they are, and I wonder if we have the will to do it, because everything comes down to dollars, and I'm saying, but what are you doing with that money over there? What's happening? Why is it going over there? Why isn't it being returned? So easily forgotten. So I sit on that committee, and I've learned an awful lot. I think sometimes the first year that you're on something, you sit and you listen, and what is it that I can do? So I'm frustrated because sometimes I can't get it done up there, but maybe I can start it from here and get it going, and that's what Jim so instructed me, and I follow his lead. Now, the other day, I had a phone call, and I'm listening to you about the electric being out, and we got a call from a 64-year-old disabled veteran living in one of our communities. And at that time, Julie was out with me, and there was one person left in the office, and she was very, very upset because this person on the other end of the line could hardly speak. And the more upset he became, the more she couldn't understand him. But what she did understand is that his electric was shut off. Now, we knew nothing about this man. We tried calling public service, okay? So we know what we have to do. We have to get him that electric turned on. It took us 3 days, but we did get his electric turned on. And we did get him connected. And Julie O'Brien did connect him to agencies to get him help. But my concern was right that day. What was happening to him right that day as he sat in his house, I've never been there, without electric, with a man that kept calling our office in a more state of panic with each phone call. Well, I need to tell you, I'm blessed with working with a great staff that went to his apartment to see what was going on, because I couldn't get local officials to go, because their answer was, what do you want me to do? Wasn't the answer I wanted to hear. So my staff went. And what they learned was that he was on medication. He obviously in a lot of pain. It wasn't that he didn't have the money. There was money. But he would forget to pay his bills. It was that simple. He needed direction. So we worked out an agreement where it would be deducted from his check and he could pay it back. But those are the kinds of things. And I left very concerned because I thought, who's watching him? Who's making sure that he's okay? You know, I grew up in a time period where I knew every single one of my neighbors, And if somebody was in trouble, we would come together, because that's the way life was. Well, life isn't like that anymore, and no one reaches out to see what's happening to their neighbor across the hall or across the block, and I don't have people taking care of people. We will connect him with the agencies, but this problem is still with me because I'm not comfortable. I'm not comfortable with what this gentleman had to go through. He didn't ask for this to happen to him. He needs help, and I just thank God that somebody told him to call our office, and we were able to help. But now we've connected him with services, and we'll make sure he gets that help. But you multiply this gentleman's experiences by all those out there that we don't know about. Some disabilities you see, some you do not see. And we need to do something about this. Housing, probably I see the need for this so greatly as I knock door to door. And sometimes we live in a society that says, not my family, I can walk away from it. And our job is to make everybody see that it is your family. This is our family. And that is where we have to go. So I am on a mission. But I am going to start where I can make a difference. And I will take your suggestions, and I will do legislation, and I will work with the county, and I will work with the local people to get things done. But I know that I have to look in my community, find that one or two special people that can do this job. So you have my support. I thank you for what you're doing. This flood, absolutely right. Once again, I see people in some of my communities that if they don't have family, what do you do? And they are reaching out to us. So listen, I wish you well. Let's keep it going, and you have my support. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Assemblywoman Wagner. I apologize to Mary. We're going to continue with Mary. I'd just like to point out, as Assemblywoman Wagner has said, and I said this for a long time, we assume that adults with disabilities have family to be there to help to meet their needs. And it's not always the case. And the question is, what do they do? But,
I'm sorry, Mary.
No problem. All right, let's go back to where we were in terms of the individual. And a story the Assemblywoman told, which kind of underscores who we're trying to look out for, and that's people that, again, are not necessarily connected to anybody or an agency or have aged in place and children live elsewhere and that kind of thing. I did try in some of the messaging on press interviews and things of that nature, and I do try to stress this for people to look out for one another and their neighbors and things of that nature. I don't know how much that gets across, but I do try to tell people. All right, standard readiness steps. Situational awareness, disaster supply kits with flashlights and batteries and things that are needed. I don't need to go through that laundry list with you, but for an individual with a disability, they've got to figure out what their specific needs are. Number one, medication. If you have to evacuate, do not leave home without it. It's the number one issue at a shelter, and we do find people, they have to evacuate in a hurry, they get nervous, they forget things, and then they forget meds that they take every day and that they rely on. Crucial, crucial, because it's going to be hard to replace that in a shelter environment. So number one is if you have medicine, take it with you, or at least make sure on you, you have a copy of what you take and what your prescription regimen is. Personal information about yourself and your disability. If you have children and it's a huge and it's catastrophic event and the area is prone to that, a copy of their IEP. that kid's history. And if you're relocated, cannot return home, and I'm talking like a Katrina type event, where you're relocated from your community for a period of time, it's very difficult to recreate that. Things like that. What arrangements with caretakers and personal care assistants are being made? The New Jersey Association of Home Care Providers made the suggestion to me, and this is something that we are going to be looking at in terms of evacuation tracking systems, and actually purchasing, like in some states have, when a person leaves, they're banded with a barcode, and then that person can be tracked every step along the way where they go, when they get to a shelter, when they return. There were many assistants and healthcare professionals trying to connect with their patients and with their consumer and could not find them because they were in a shelter. So luckily, at least in the shore areas, we did not have people out of their homes for long periods of time. Northern Jersey was a little bit different in the central part of the state. But what are the arrangements with caretakers? Are you going to communicate with them? All that. Obviously, utility registries. One thing you do have to be aware of with that is that if a whole area is without power and that person is on a registry for priority restoration, they're not going to get the priority restoration until the whole area comes back. And that's something to consider. Once they start working in that area, then they'll be prioritized. But, you know, that area, that expanse of area is out for a period of time. They're not going to get it. We had water in the streets in some areas of Passaic County for almost 3 weeks. They just couldn't get into places to repair the electric and restore it. So that's the consideration there. We also have a special needs registry that we have, a software application that we have promoted and have our counties using. It's called Register Ready, and the web address is www.registerready.nj.gov. We had one county who used, Salem County, who called every individual on their registry to do a welfare check, make sure they were okay, and evacuated the ones that needed to be evacuated, and also brought them back into their homes when power was out. Salem County actually got close to 10 inches of rain. They got most of the rain during Irene. But we do have a registry system. Now, there's pros and cons to registries. I'm not going to get into those now. Just know in this state we do have one. All the counties have access to it. And it is a tool that can be used. Atlantic County, as the week before the hurricane, I'm aware of how they used it. They did contact people that were on it to do checks and things of that nature. So during the storm, we had, before the storm, we had close to 13,000 people on our registry. Afterwards, it was over 15,000. In that four-week period of time, right before the storm and right after. So we're going to figure out a way to operationalize that a little better, but be aware it's out there and it to be used. All right, access and functional needs in the community. What we're going to have in each county, and I was just getting ready to launch this, and then we had a visit from Irene, so we're back a little bit, a few weeks on the timing, but we're going to have an individual point of contact in each county for access and functional needs disaster planning. So be aware of that. There'll be a contact in each county. I'm going to be developing that resource, developing that system, and they'll be working with the OEM. They'll be working with the mass care folks. They'll be making sure there's transportation available. Working with the different voluntary organizations active in disaster, that's what VOAD means up there, for long-term recovery needs, because that's what they are heavily involved in. They're not first responders, the VOADs, but they're second responders, and they're going to be very busy in the state in the upcoming months. But they were going to be the focal point, and I'm going to try to drill down a little bit into these counties and make sure that we have that system in place in each counties. I'm not going to go through every one of these bullets, but the yellow bullet there is what you would be interested in. What we want to do also in each county is to form a functional assessment and service team. What that basically means is we'll have a human services strike team able to go out and respond to smaller events. You know, the evacuation of a high-rise complex is not necessarily a major disaster, but that's an emergency management event. And you'll see folks coming out when you have a lot of people in an apartment complex coming out. They have a wide variety of needs. They need to be sheltered for a period of time. How do we deal with that? Well, we're going to try to pull together local experts in disability, aging, senior services, mental health. So we'll have a strike team available if the sheltering needs comes up, take the burden off the emergency management system and the Red Cross, let them do what they're supposed to be doing, and then have the specialty areas to address unmet needs. The agencies have not spoken about the agencies. That photograph there, I'll talk to you about that in a minute, but that is the, we have a citizen volunteer initiative called the Community Emergency Response Teams, and they're local teams which they're trained in basic emergency management. They're not EMTs when they come out of the CERT program, they're not firefighters, but they learn some basic things, basic first aid, basic you know, just about emergency management, how to work together and how to help each other. They were phenomenal in Irene. In 2 weeks before and after Irene, the community emergency response teams and the Medical Reserve Corps volunteers put in 42,000 hours. 42,000 hours, and that's statewide from High Point to Cape May. They worked in the shelters, they cleaned out people's houses, they helped people with disabilities in the shelters, so phenomenal. That program is available to people with disabilities, and that young woman there has a disability. She's taking the program. They're discussing how to use that material to do a search and rescue exercise. The point is, you may not be able to physically do that search and rescue, but you can tell somebody else how to do it that may not have taken the training. So that's kind of the point. Bergen County was the first county to involve people with disabilities in that program. Jim, I know you've run several classes up there already. Mercer County also has been involved with it, engaging the disability community. So we want to continue that. We are bringing in disaster casework managers, but we want to try to formalize our disaster casework management plan so that there are more people involved in long-term recovery. This is the first disaster we've had where we've had that type of need. We were working on it before Irene. It was still in the planning and development stages, so we're going to have FEMA resources come in, train our local people, and be able to get our DCM plan together. Why is that important? Because people with access and functional needs typically have longer-term recovery issues. Spoke to you about the FAST team, spoke to you about Register Ready. Coop didn't talk to you about that. The agencies. Talked about the government's role, talked about the individual's role. What about the agencies? They need to be able to continue delivering services when these events happen. Many consumers, the ones that are connected with agencies, rely on those services, sometimes even on a daily basis. And This was the first disaster I've heard where I've gotten a lot of reports of agencies being impacted. Roads itself, if any of you have field personnel out there, we had 1,700 roads in the state impacted by Irene, 700 roads. So being able to get out there, deliver medication, deliver meals, provide whatever service is being delivered was a real challenge. So we have to, some have their offices flooded, offices impacted, just a host of issues for agencies. What we are working on is a planning template for them for disaster planning. We're going to go out, we're going to be delivering that template and delivering some training on that. So that'll be free for you, and we want to be able to have that. Because when FEMA comes in, they come in, they're able to give financial assistance, but they do not come in and provide services. And those services are critical that some of you are delivering. So that's why we need to think about business continuity planning. Talked about the CERT training. There's Kelly Ruba in that picture actually taking the CERT training. Department of Health and Senior Services has funded equipment caches in the seven southern counties. They're expanding that to Ocean and Monmouth. And I think we're going to definitely be looking at medical needs and access and functional needs equipment caches statewide as we go into the future. The equipment for the shelters has got to be there. There's no question about that. Training for first responders regarding individuals with disabilities, that is now a requirement. We do have one of our Centers for Independent Living, the Mercer Hunterdon Progressive Center for Independent Living, that also does first responder training, not only on disabilities awareness, but also on how to work when you are trying to rescue or you're aiding someone that's in a specialized vehicle, how to extricate that person without getting them, without destroying the vehicle, and without making sure that vehicle can remain intact. We have some programs on the table that we're looking at, the deaf and hard of hearing community. We have already run the one course, and we're going to be looking at other training programs as well. In Cape May County, we involved for the first time people from the deaf and hard of hearing community in the CERT program, and we're able to get interpreters for that, and that worked out quite well. That's just a little bit about what we're doing. We're certainly going to be looking at Irene and trying to take some of these projects, see where we need adjustments, see what we hope, what we maybe have not thought of, and try to work on that. But I just want to leave you with the statement that the access and functional needs community is a priority of the office. There are individuals working on that. We're going to extend that to the counties. I would like to hear about your experiences also with Irene and any ideas that you may have had or that you have to make the emergency management system stronger and as attentive and responsive as it can be to the disability community. So my contact number is up there. My email is up there. If it takes me a day or two to get back to you, just have patience. I appreciate that, especially at this time when we're in recovery. But I will get back to you. But I am interested in hearing back from you. Are we doing Q&A or are we doing Q&A or anything like that? Do we have time for that? You're on a schedule. If anybody have questions, we do have a minute. Yes, Jim. Well, the SILs are in the disaster recovery centers. Now, that is a memorandum of understanding that the National SIL organization made with FEMA. So that didn't even happen. And that's like a national standard. So they were. They're on the county team in Mercer, and I don't think the county team was activated. Some local teams were, but they have definitely been contributing to the recovery process. Anyone else? All right. I thank you for your time today, your attention, and the invitation to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. We're going to, since we're going to use that extra time to move the schedule, the extra time from the cancellation of Senator Vitale's presentation, move right into our discussion on autism. And is Deborah still here? Deborah? Okay. I'd like to begin by introducing Deborah Christina Waterlick. I met Deborah a couple of years ago at one of the events, and Deborah is, I guess, the founder as well as the president of Putting the Pieces Together, which is an organization of parents of children with autism, and she has had some really outstanding events. It's not just an organization where parents meet. She has a series of events to get children involved in activities, and she's expressed concern and in emails I've had with her about what happens to these children, not only now, but later on. So we're very fortunate to have Deborah with us. So at this time, I'd like to introduce Deborah Christina Waterlick.
I'd like to start off by thanking Dr. Pizzori for having me here. It's an honor. My daughter and I started putting the pieces together over 6 years ago, started out as a support group for parents of children with autism. And later we realized that we're no different than any other parent of a child with a disability, so we opened it up to everyone. And we found that speaker meetings were our best way of educating ourselves, so we decided to do an abundance of speaker meetings on every subject imaginable. Another concern from the parents were that there was nothing for the kids to do. So we slowly started what became an incredibly large recreation group for children with autism and every other disability that you can think of. We have T-ball, soccer, bowling, basketball, flag football. Our kids play center field on the Lyndhurst High School football field, artificial turf being announced. It's amazing. We have parties, Christmas, Easter, all of that. We do social groups and peer models. One of the main programs that I'm so proud of besides our dance program is our cheer program. Our girls go out into typical competitions and they stunt and they cheer and they showcase. They do an entire routine. They've been to Six Flags, they've been to Atlantic City Nationals, and I feel that this is an eye-opener for everyone out there that knows absolutely nothing about autism or any other disability, that these children have dreams, they can fulfill them, and I'm proud to say that our girls are the recipient this year of the Salute to Champions Award, which they will be getting on October 28th. Another thing is, I think that being a parent and a grandparent of a child with autism has given us the ability to see what the parents really need and what their fears are, and I think that helps us to better help those families in need. But I did, I wasn't as good as the other people. I did write my speech because I really wanted to cover every base, and what Sal asked me to talk about were the needs of our autistic children. Even though we affect all disabilities, I am versed on autism because of my grandson. I live with him. So that's what I'm here to speak about, is the needs of these families, what's not out there for our children, and what needs to change. As I said, my grandson is 10. He has classic autism. So that means that he can't have a conversation. He can't tell me if somebody's hurting him. And unfortunately, last year we found out firsthand that he was being abused by a teacher in his classroom. So Tyler is now homeschooled by me in my home where I know he's safe. So that's just a little background on Tyler. Tyler and his generation are the baby boomers of autism. Our adults with autism were the pioneers. In the 1970s, the number for autism was 1 in 10,000. In the 1990s, it was 1 in 1,000. When we hit the year 2001, the numbers started drastically climbing, 1 in 250. The start of the baby boomers. Now we're 1 in 94, according to the CDC. As a grandparent of a child with autism, my focus is on the children and adults that are already here, the children and adults that are lacking so much to help them prepare for a life without their caregivers. More research should be done on effective treatment, interventions, and therapies. Something needs to be done to ensure that they have a chance to lead an independent and productive life. There are many schools out there that I refer to as glorified babysitting, at best, and abuse runs rampant because our children can't tell you if somebody is abusing them, and or nobody believes them. They are the perfect target for these situations. We should have more supervision and monitoring of schools to ensure teaching, not babysitting, and to ensure safety in the classroom. I believe that teachers should be held accountable for their actions. This is not being done now, and they hold our children's future in their hands. Schools should have a revised statewide standard to uphold or be shut down. There should be a committee that researches and compiles a standard of excellence in teaching our children and makes sure it's implemented. Our children's education is an investment in them and should be taken more seriously. No longer should a parent peek into a classroom and see their child laying on the floor in the corner by themselves. They can and should be taught. They are there to be taught, not to find an easy way to get through the day, because each day they babysit rather than teach is a day lost for our children. Every time these kids are just sitting in a classroom getting through that day, that's a day lost for them. When they hit 21, it's done. They release those kids to us, and we're taking care of a 21-year-old baby that didn't learn any life skills, any social skills, or any skills to help them get by in their life without us when we're gone. If the teachers don't do their job, they dump the financial responsibility on the state to support them forever. This is penny wise and dollar foolish. The children should have safe transportation with competent aides and drivers on the bus. I can go on about abuse and deaths that have occurred on the school bus that most parents need in order to transport their children to and from school. A bus that a child may be on for anywhere from a half an hour, if they're lucky, to 2 or 3 hours if their school is a distance, which in most cases it is rather than not. Children being forgotten on school buses in extreme heat, ending up in hospitals, or worse, dead. Cameras on the school buses and video monitoring in classrooms is a must. Questions like the right school, IEPs, therapies, taking on a second mortgage to pay for those therapies, bullying, abuse, puberty, adult day programs, guardianships, and of course the big question, what will happen to our children when we're gone, plague us in the middle of the night? Trying to figure out how we can outlive our child or live forever is not an option. There will come a day when we're gone. Did we all do our part to ensure that our adults can take care of themselves and support themselves so they're not living on SSI and in a state institution at the mercy of someone that may mistreat them at the very least or abuse them and do unspeakable things to them after we have loved and cared for them all our lives, again, because they are an easy target? And all this at the expense of the state because autism has drained all of our savings. The waiting list for group homes are just too long, and something has to be done. I think we should look into modeling the 55 and older communities for our autistic adults. This would satisfy the COAH requirements for some areas and alleviate overcrowding the school districts because this would be an adult autism community. We need safe housing, and I have a plan. This is a win-win for everybody. Communities need to be educated. With the statistics we are facing, ignorance is not an option. There should be awareness programs in all public schools to teach the children that our children aren't children that should be feared. We need to educate them about autism and teach them to live side by side with our children and adults because it's a reality. Our children are here and the numbers are high. If this is not done, I see our adults becoming victims of hate crimes and our children being bullied. Again, the real stories I have heard about bullying are heartbreaking. We can't close our eyes to this. We have to educate. It's the only way our children and adults will have a safe future. There should also be community awareness so police, fire departments, EMTs, business owners, and the families that live in the community understand autism. This is a must. I think the biggest problem for adults with autism, besides housing, is that when they reach 21, the schools have not prepared them for life or independence. No real vocational training, no real life skills, no socialization skills. So they are not prepared for the real world, and that means when we're gone, they have no way of living an independent life and will live on the system forever. I'm not talking about stocking shelves or pushing carts or other minimum wage jobs, but real jobs with the right vocational training from an early age on. Vocational schools geared for autistic children and teens should be available throughout New Jersey. If we don't address these issues, our baby boomers will surely break the bank. New Jersey has one of the highest rates of autism, and New Jersey will never be able to support them. So what's the solution? The two-person salary in a household is not an option for our parents. I see moms that went to school to be doctors, lawyers, professionals of all walks of life, turning into stay-at-home moms because our children weren't accepted at a daycare or an aftercare facility, or because they need to run their children to different therapies after work, so working isn't an option. Therapies and social programs that are so vital to our children's success are so expensive, but so needed. You must have out-of-network benefits to get most of these therapies covered, and not everyone has out-of-network benefits. But even if they do, there's a cap on what insurance companies will cover. These therapies, as I have mentioned before, have caused parents to put a second mortgage on their house. So my question is, why isn't there a cap on these service providers? Why can't they cap what they can charge? RDI, listening therapy, social skills groups, floor time, and so many other therapies that parents have seen success rates with are so expensive and yet not covered. They're getting rich quick because of our children's diagnosis, and the parents are at their mercy because they want their child to succeed so badly, no price is too high. This is not acceptable. There needs to be a cap on what these service providers can charge, just like doctors have caps on what they can charge for their services. Too many people are profiting on our children. And though autism has no boundaries, and rich as well as poor families are blessed with our children, it seems that only the wealthy children have the opportunity to have the best therapy money can buy. That doesn't seem fair. Again, without these therapies, adults with autism have a greater chance of needing financial assistance till the day they die, and that is going to cost a lot. Recent studies have shown an estimated life cost for a child with autism to be $3.2 million. Day programs need to be started that are geared for the needs of an adult with autism because most programs are not trained to work with our adults and know their needs. They need to be safe and well-staffed. Abuse has to be non-existent. Real vocational training has to take place. Knowledge of autism, a must. And dignity and self-esteem should be a priority. Parents are searching in tears trying to figure out what to do with their adults when they reach 21. The state should give incentives to anyone interested in starting a safe day program geared towards an autistic adult. This day program could finish the job that schools never started. Educate them in vocational skills to secure a job, provide them with real life skills and social skills, and give them a feeling of purpose and self-worth. Studies have shown that among identical twins, if one child has autism, there is a 60 to 96% chance the other child will have autism. Parents who have a child with autism have a 2 to 8% chance of having a second child who is affected. And those siblings not affected seem to have learning disabilities, sensory issues, or something that requires some sort of therapy or addressing. Hmm? We want our child to succeed so badly. We need New Jersey to stand behind us. We need them to do the things that our children need, otherwise they have no chance of succeeding, and we as the taxpayers and New Jersey will have to pay for them for the rest of their lives. The cold, hard facts are things need to change. And if they don't, this state will bear the burden of our children forever, and that is a costly burden. There isn't one parent I know that wants their child to live off the system collecting SSI or die in a state facility. They want success for their child. So the bottom line is we have to work together, parents, teachers, government officials, to make sure that all is being done to ensure that our children grow up to be a functioning part of society. With a real job, living an independent life in a safe environment, and growing old happy, just like any other parent wants for their child. These children did not ask to have autism, but they have autism, and they are here, and we have to find a way to let them live their life with dignity, with some normalcy, and with their rights protected in a safe environment. I'm not an expert. I'm just a grandmother of a child with autism. But I can tell you that I lay awake at night at 3:30 in the morning trying to figure out what the hell is going to happen to my grandson when I'm gone. And we're not there yet, and we have so far to go. We need people like you to help us ensure that our children will be safe when we're gone.
Thank you, Deborah. You were terrific. At this time, I'd like to introduce Carol Sevely. Carol is in New York, and she has been an advocate for quite a few years for the needs of children with special needs as a parent. Karen has an interesting background, although I think many of us have taken detours in life to get where we are and doing what we're doing, and sometimes we wonder how it happened. But Carol started off as a Wall Street executive. She has an MBA, and we met because we wound up inadvertently in a graduate program in disability law at New York Law School, and have networked since. Carol is going to share with you what she's doing in New York, which is basically fighting for the rights, the civil rights and the human rights of children with disabilities and parents of children with disabilities. Carol? Your PowerPoint's right here. You just hit this click to go on to the next slide.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Hi, good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Pizarro for asking me to come today, and thank all of the people here, all the representatives that are taking time out of their day to listen and fight for children with disabilities and adults with disabilities. My experience, as Sal has said, has been a little varied. Right now, I'm very passionate about the rights of children. My focus of my business is education, because I feel that education in this country is not being afforded to children with disabilities. And as you'll see in my presentation, prior to 1973, little fun fact, I don't know if anybody knows this in this room, I'm sure Sal does, but prior to 1973 in this country, children with autism were not entitled to a public education. It's outrageous. And if you think about all the children now that do have autism, if they were alive 30 years ago, 40 years ago, they would not have been educated. Some of these statistics other people have quoted, I didn't know that when I was putting this together, but the average cost for an individual with an ASD is $3.2 million over the cost of their life. That's a huge amount of money for interventions so that they can have access to programs that we take for granted. Going to the movies, going to school, we all take that for granted. But in order to provide access for individuals with disabilities, particularly in ASD, $3.2 million, that's a lot of money. Our healthcare costs for these children, a lot higher. we end up going to psychiatrists, psychologists, neurologists, you name it, speech therapists. If you want to get access to school, you have to go to individuals like neurologists, psychiatrists, et cetera, to be able to substantiate that your child has needs. This costs a lot more money. Costs a lot more money than anybody else has to pay. And most people, most of my clients, I have my own business where I help individuals with disabilities, generally children in K to 12. These parents don't have the money to get these services for their children, and they're dependent on state organizations to get them. And I have kids that are in fifth grade, sixth grade, by where they're supposed to be. They're functioning at a first grade level or below. I had a client that was 18 years old who wanted a high school diploma and couldn't get it because he had no credits. These are horrible situations, and it's a responsibility of all of us who are not disabled to help them. A few more statistics, of course, that everybody else has kind of quoted, but about 13% of children are considered to have a developmental disability. That's a significant percentage, and I believe it's actually higher than that. You know, if you look around and you look in the school districts, most schools have at least 15%, 15 to 18% of children that are classified that are getting some sort of special education services. I just wanted to kind of put that out there before I got started on rights. The program that Sal and I both came through at New York Law School was very much civil rights oriented. So Sal has asked me to talk about rights. And I think at the end of the day, you know, you've got some basic fundamental rights. And that's what it's about. We all have these rights. But unfortunately, if you're disabled, some people think that you don't have rights and you're not entitled to your rights, but you are. Parents have rights by virtue of the fact that their disabled child has rights. So your disabled child is really the one that has these rights, but that person, that individual, can't fight for their own rights because they usually don't have the communication skills and no one's going to listen to a minor. So until their child is 18 years old, parents are advocating for them. At 18, unless you take guardianship of your child legally, you really can't exercise those rights. But your disabled child can voluntarily let you help them or let an advocate help them so that they can still have access to those rights and not be, not have their inability to communicate make them suffer and not have rights. Just another fact, disabled adults lose their right to vote under legal guardianship, which is unfortunately a shame, but some individuals do need to have the legal guardianship, and that is one of the downsides of legal guardianship. Getting very basic, what are human rights? Human rights are inalienable rights, rights which each and every human being has by virtue of being a human being. Pretty simple. They're absolute, they cannot be forfeited, they cannot be challenged. Every single solitary person has these rights because they're a human being. In this country, throughout the world, if you have a disability, it is assumed that you don't have rights. These are some examples of human rights: right to life, right to be free from torture, right to be free from slavery and forced labor, right to liberty and security, right to a fair trial, freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, freedom of expression, and a right to education, which is my favorite. Kind of seems like the United States Constitution, and here we go. United States Constitution. I'm kind of going to bring you through a little bit of a historical rendition of rights. So you have the Bill of Rights, which I'm sure everyone's pretty familiar with, freedom of speech. You've got right to a trial by jury. Got lots of rights here. And of course, throughout the Constitution and the rest of the amendments, but the first 10 amendments are the Bill of Rights. Kind of skipping a couple hundred years here. Back in 1948, the United Nations, there was a committee, and Eleanor Roosevelt was on that committee, that put together a Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was not a convention or a treaty, and it was just something that people looked at and countries started looking at it. It was the result of the experiences of the Second World War and the atrocities in that Second World War that gave a global awareness that there were vulnerable populations within this world that were being discriminated against and were not being afforded their rights because of their disabilities or their differences. There are 30 articles in the UDHR. It's the foundation of international human rights law. It's not binding law, but it became customary in member states as people chose to take on the declaration within their own countries. I'm going to read some of the preamble. It's the language in some of the slides that I have, and the reason I put them in there is because the language is so strong. And I think, you know, fundamentally, we all kind of have to step back and say, you know, we all have these rights, but most people don't recognize that people with disabilities have these rights. Everybody has these rights. So we have this Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's not for disabled people yet. But this is for everybody, regardless of who they are. So whereas recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. Whereas disregard and contempt for human rights resulted in barbarous acts which have outraged the conscience of mankind and the advent of a world in which human beings shall enjoy freedom of speech and belief and freedom from fear and what has been proclaimed as the highest aspiration of the common people. I'm not going to read through all of this. And I've noted some of the different articles, and it's at the end, you can actually go on to the United Nations website, and you can read all of these articles. If you want to see, there's another convention that I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. They're so specific about what everybody's rights are, and you know, these are just the articles, and then there's on the UN website, if you actually read through it in the description of what the rights are, it's overwhelming to see, you know, we have a lot of rights. We have an incredible amount of rights. Article 1, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. Article 3, everyone has the right to life, liberty, and security of person. If you start taking that apart, you know, security of person, our disabled community does not have that. They do not have that. It's not right. All are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. The disabled population is not. All are entitled to equal protection against any discrimination in violation of this declaration and against any incitement to such discrimination. This is 1948. This is not like 2008. This is 1948. There is an awareness. There's a global awareness that we have to actually define rights. Article 12, no one shall be subjected to arbitrary interference with his privacy, family, home, or correspondence, not to attacks upon his honor and reputation. Everyone has the right to the protection of law against such interference or attacks. Article 26, everyone has the right to education, my favorite one. Education should be free, at least in the elementary and fundamental stages. Elementary education shall be compulsory. We now get to the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, which was a huge, huge achievement back in the early 70s. And as I said, prior to the enactment of the Rehabilitation Act, autistic children in this country were not entitled to an education. The primary focus of the Rehabilitation Act was vocational training and rehabilitation. Section 501 requires non-discrimination in employment by federal agencies, and 504 introduced the concept of reasonable accommodation. The Rehabilitation Act became the act where most people, if you were fighting for something in schools, you were going under Section 504 until we come up to the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. Section 504 states, no otherwise qualified handicapped individual in the United States as defined in Section 7.6 shall, solely by reason of his handicap, be excluded from the participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination in any program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. So in order for this to apply, an agency actually has to be receiving federal funds in same way, shape, or form. Now we get to the Americans with Disabilities Act. And some of the language in the findings and the purpose, I thought it was interesting to bring about because, you know, now we're talking 1990 here, and we're still even, you know, you have the Bill of Rights in this country. Hundreds of years ago, you have the UDHR, which everybody apparently in the globe is adhering to somewhat, yet in 1990, we still have to have a law for people with disabilities, because the UDHR was for everybody, okay? Well, in 1990, you know, it was like this population, people with disabilities were still being discriminated against. They had these rights, they still have these rights. They didn't need this law to get these rights. But yet, because they're a vulnerable population, and I'm glad that this did get enacted, the Congress enacted the Americans with Disabilities Act to protect people with disabilities, to protect their rights. But they had them by virtue of the fact that they were human beings. But yet we have laws now to protect the rights of people with disabilities because they are considered different than everybody else. Findings, individuals with disabilities are a discrete and insular minority who have been faced with restrictions and limitations, subjected to a history of purposeful, unequal treatment, and relegated to a position of political powerlessness in our society based on characteristics that are beyond the control of such individuals and resulting from stereotypic assumptions not truly indicative of the individual ability of such individuals to participate in and contribute to society. I mean, it's powerful language, and I think it's, you know, helpful for everyone to see, you know, the language that's actually out there. I mean, we think of the Americans with Disabilities Act, and people think that basically what the Americans with Disabilities Act did was provide handicapped access to people. It was more considered physical handicaps. But that was not the purpose. It was for all disabilities. There we go. Okay. The purpose of the Americans with Disabilities Act was to provide a clear and comprehensive national mandate for the elimination of discrimination against individuals with disabilities, to invoke the sweep of congressional authority, including the power to enforce the 14th Amendment due process rights, and to relegate commerce in order to address the major areas of discrimination faced day to day by people with disabilities. The act was amended in 2008 as a result of the issue of narrow interpretations of disability by the courts. Many of the cases that came under the ADA were the courts throughout the country narrowly interpreted the word disability, so that very few people actually prevailed with their court cases on the Americans with Disabilities Act. Since 2008, that definition has been broadened to include a lot more disabilities. So it's become a lot more powerful, and the courts have not been interpreting it as narrowly. Another thing that happened with Americans with Disabilities Act, there was a court case, Olmstead versus LC. LC, there were actually two mentally retarded ladies that were living in Pennhurst State Hospital in Pennsylvania, which, if anybody knows about Pennhurst, and I believe it's been closed a long time ago, but the Pennhurst case, the Olmstead case, and you might hear Olmstead Acts. Each state has their Olmstead Acts where they're actually taking people in psychiatric facilities and they're moving them into the community, into different housing, sometimes with their families. And that all came as a result of a case, Olmstead versus LC, in Pennsylvania. It was one of the first cases on the Americans with Disabilities Act, and that kind of led to deinstitutionalization and the closing of some really horrific, horrific institutions. See if I can get that back. Okay. The ADA has five titles. Title one deals with employment, and I think most people kind of think of the ADA as all those employment things that you have to have. Title two covers discrimination by public entities, that's state or local governments. Title three deals with discrimination in public accommodations and services operated by private entities. Title four dealt with telecommunications, is now part of another section. It's 47 USC section 255, so that's another code. It's actually been pulled out of the Americans with Disabilities Act. And Title V contains miscellaneous provisions. I hesitate to talk about the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act because my partner here is so, well, wrote most of it, but I'm just going to give a little brief overview because it is part of our rights, rights of people with disabilities. The Individuals with Disabilities Act is a law ensuring services to children with disabilities throughout the nation. IDEA governs how states and public agencies provide early intervention, special education, and related services to more than 6.5 million eligible infants, toddlers, children, and youths with disabilities.
Infants and toddlers with disabilities, birth to two, and their families receive early intervention services under IDEA Part C. Children and youths aged 3 to 21 receive special education and related services under IDEA Part B. It was also known as Public Law 94-142. The 2004 date is the latest authorization, reauthorization. Actually started, the first one was an Education Act back in 1975 and has been reauthorized many times, but the latest one is 2004. I just wanted to read the findings. Again, the language of some of these things that I've taken out, I think is very important. It's very strong, so I thought it was worthwhile to actually note that. The findings section of the IDEA, disability is a natural part of the human experience and in no way diminishes the right of individuals to participate in or contribute to society. Improving educational results for children with disabilities is an essential element of our national policy of ensuring equality of opportunity, full participation, independent living, and economic self-sufficiencies for individuals with disabilities. The purpose of IDEA was to ensure that all children with disabilities have available to them a free, appropriate public education that emphasizes special education and related services designed to meet their unique needs and prepare them for further education, employment, and independent living. And that's the key. IDEA, the public school system in this country, is supposed to be providing our children with opportunity for further education, employment, and independent living. That is not happening. That is not happening. I can tell you it's not happening through all my clients. I focus on Long Island is where my business is. And I can't tell you how many people come to me, their children are not being educated. It is not being afforded to these children. Yet the law is here, but the families don't have the money to fight it. And the result is that kids are not being educated. Which law protects you and when? We have the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. That's a general disability law that covers all individuals with disabilities, regardless of age or disability. The Rehabilitation Act, if you bring a case under the Rehabilitation Act, it is a tougher case to win because the act is broad. You have a better chance if you can qualify under the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is more specific than the Rehabilitation Act and creates stronger protections. It's generally used for disabled adults who have aged out of IDEA, but it can be used for any age or any disability. So even if you do have a child that's getting services under IDEA, you can actually, if it doesn't qualify under IDEA, you can actually go after accommodations under the Americans with Disabilities Act. And then, of course, we have the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. It affords all of the rights of the Rehabilitation Act. It affords numerous rights which extend further than the Rehabilitation Act. It applies to education only, and it applies to individuals from birth to age 21. Once you graduate from high school or reach the age of 21, you are no longer entitled to services under IDEA. The next thing I wanted to talk about, so we've kind of come through just the history of the law and the protections for people with disabilities. There's a new convention, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. That's 2008. The preamble states, reaffirming the universality, indivisibility, interdependence, and interrelatedness of all human rights and fundamental freedoms, and the need for persons with disabilities to be guaranteed their full employment without discrimination. Pretty strong language. Recognizing that disability is an evolving concept and that disability results from the interaction between persons with impairments and attitudinal and environmental barriers that hinders their full and effective participation in society on an equal basis with others. Recognizing also that discrimination against any person on the basis of disability is a violation of the inherent dignity and worth of the human person. Kind of, if you think about those human rights that we all have, we now have a convention, a United Nations convention, for the rights of persons with disabilities, which is basically giving persons with disabilities the same rights that everybody else has, which really isn't fair. Unfortunately, it's necessary, but it's not really fair. There are several articles, and I would encourage everybody, if you really want to see what rights you personally have, what your children have, anyone that you know with disabilities, this is for disabilities, this is a very comprehensive document of rights. It's, if you read that and you can think of a right that's not listed, let me know, because it's very, very detailed, very, very specific, and has taken all doctrines from the UDHR, from different constitutions around the world, and put it into one document protecting the rights of persons with disabilities. They have Article 5, equality and non-discrimination. Article 6 was women with disabilities. Article 7, children with disabilities, equal recognition before the law, freedom from exploitation, violence, and abuse. They also have right to education, which is interesting, right to education, that people with disabilities actually have the right to education. They always had that right, but now they really have that right. Well, they can fight for it in court, but not in the United States yet. The CRPD is the first comprehensive human rights treaty of the 21st century, so it's a biggie. The CRPD and its optional protocol was adopted on December 13, 2006 at the United Nations headquarters in New York. It was open for signatures on March 30, 2007. On March 30, 2007, there were 82 signatories to the convention, 44 signatories to the optional protocol, and one ratification of the convention. That's the highest number of signatories the UN has experienced on the opening day of a convention. So it's huge. There's a lot of focus, and this is huge. The convention entered into force on May 3rd, 2008. President Obama signed the convention on July 30th of 2009. Okay, so we signed the convention. But in order for us to actually be able to prevail and be able to go to the United Nations and fight a cause under the CRPD, he's going to have to ratify the convention, and that has not happened yet. The United States has not ratified the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. There are currently 153 signatories to the convention, 90 signatories to the optional protocol, 105 ratifications of the convention, and 63 ratifications of the optional protocol. I actually printed out the list of all of the countries that have ratified, that have signed the convention and have ratified. It's 7 pages long, and the United States has not ratified this convention. And it's really a shame. It's really a shame because there are a lot of countries out there. There are 105 countries that have ratified this convention, and the United States is not one of them. If anyone wants to see that list, I can leave that up there. I pulled some of the language out of the convention because I thought it was worthwhile for people to listen to and to just listen to the words. The convention follows decades of work by the United Nations to change attitudes and approaches to persons with disabilities. It takes to a new height the movement from viewing persons with disabilities as objects of charity, medical treatment, and social protection towards viewing persons with disabilities as subjects with rights, who are capable of claiming those rights and making decisions for their lives based on their free and informed consent, as well as being active members of society. The convention is intended as a human rights instrument with an explicit social development dimension. It adopts a broad categorization of persons with disabilities and reaffirms that all persons with all types of disabilities must enjoy all human rights and fundamental freedoms. It clarifies and qualifies how all categories of rights apply to persons with disabilities and identifies areas where adaptations have to be made for persons with disabilities to effectively exercise their rights and areas where their rights have been violated and where protection of rights must be reinforced. I also want to just note a few resources. The IDEA website is http://idea.ed.gov, so there's no www in there. The United Nations is www.un.org, and the Center for Disease Control and Prevention is www.cdc.gov. As I said before, education is my passion. I was on Wall Street for many, many years, and my daughter, who's with me today, was diagnosed with autism. She was 4 years old. When she was in kindergarten, my husband and I were told she would never learn to read or write. Give it up. Well, I'm a feisty person. I'm the youngest of seven. I don't give it up. I don't. I'm persistent, and I constantly keep going after it. My daughter is now 17. She's a senior in the mainstream at the public high school, and she's applying to colleges. She has a 3.3 GPA, which is phenomenal, with accommodations that she has been getting, and had every teacher that she had adhere to her IEP, she'd have more than a 4.0. So I guess my message to everybody is, it is a fight. It's a daily fight. There is not a day that goes by that I do not have a phone conversation or a meeting at her school fighting for her IEP. I'm not well-liked, but that's okay. I'm not there to make friends. My daughter got educated, and she would not have gotten educated if I didn't fight every single day. I should not have had to fight. She had those rights. There are laws now that say she has those rights. I should not have had to fight what I have had to fight for her to get that. Most people don't have the ambition and the wherewithal to do that fight. And there are many parents out there that don't know what to do. They're so overwhelmed with the challenges of the behaviors and the management. You know, children that need assistance with the bathroom and they're 15, 16, 20 years old. These are very difficult situations, and the parents are spending all of their time managing their children. They don't have the time to also do the fight so that they can get education. If we don't educate this population, we are going to have serious problems as this population, which is now growing, starts entering into out of IDEA 21, and where are they going to go? There aren't programs for them. There are numbers of homeless people. The statistics are alarming, and it's all unnecessary. So I encourage each and every one of you, to the extent that you have the capacity to fight for these kids, to get them educated. They are capable. They can learn. They do learn. And if they do learn, they do not become dependent on society. Thank you very much.
Does anyone have any questions for Carol? None? Okay, Carol, thank you very much. Well, we've moved along a little ahead of schedule, basically because of Senator Vitale's cancellation. I want to thank all of you for coming. You're certainly welcome to hang out and network. I would encourage you to meet as many people here, exchange business cards before you go. We are, Dr. Rickards and I are going to try to summarize today's proceedings using the videotape of today's events. And by the way, the whole institute is going to put the entire day's proceedings on the website, and if I'm not mistaken, staff can correct me if I'm mistaken, they're also going to break it up into individual presentations. So you'll be able to see this on the website. If you have any questions for any of us, by now everyone should have my email address. Feel free to get in touch. As I said, feel free to network with each other and exchange business cards before you leave. And I want to thank all of you for coming. Thank you.